got Kalen Chase in here again. Thank you very much. And Nick Morris, thank you, sir, for coming. Really appreciate it. Anytime. So you guys have a new single out?
It's coming out soon. It's coming out, I believe.
When's it coming out, bud?
You tell me. Say the number.
It's the 23rd, dude.
The 23rd of September. It's a cover of Christina Perry's Thousand Years, Team Edward, Team Jacob, Team Vampire. And it's going to be awesome.
So the new single out is A Thousand Years,
yep,
right?
Out on the 9/23, which
9/23.
Is September.
Good job, bud.
But yes.
He's proud of you.
He had to remind me at the beginning. Yeah.
You guys want to set up for that and play it for us?
Well, yeah, let's do it.
Okay.
And I'll bullshit with Rob while you guys get ready.
Yeah, that's a great... Yeah. Great thing, man.
That'd be cool to, you know, come back to your brother and then, you know, make hits and just bang it out.
It's nice because I know all of his bullshit.
I don't know.
And you have that trust. The trust, right? Thank you, guys.
Yeah. That seems like pretty good.
Whoa!
Yeah.
You're doing great.
That's how I test. That's how I
You didn't puke on the mic, did you?
No, I was just pretending that getting orally sodomized.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Sure. Maybe you are.
Hey, it's a tip for the kids out there. Adult kids, you know. Just pretend. Never mind. It's just a microphone. Just relax, people.
No, my mouth doesn't feel safe listening to this podcast. It doesn't feel safe. I need... It's
Don't
not
listen.
A safe mouth place for my mouth.
Shut up. Okay. How's that sound, Rob?
Good. I brought it down a little bit. You're good.
All right. You want to give this thing a go, buddy?
Let's do it.
Heart beats fast, colors and promises. How to be brave? How can I love when I'm afraid to fall? But watching you stand alone, all of my doubts suddenly goes away somehow. One step closer. I have died every day waiting for you. Darling, don't be afraid. I have loved you for a thousand years. I love you for a thousand more. Time stands still, beauty in all she is. I will not wait. I will not let anything take away what's standing in front of me. Every breath, every hour has come to this. One step. I have loved you for a thousand years. I love you for a thousand more. And all along I believe I would find you. Time has brought your heart to me. And I have loved you for a thousand years. I love you for a one step closer.
waiting for you. Darling, don't be afraid, 'cause I have loved you for a thousand years. I love you for a thousand more. And all along I believed I would find you. Time has brought your heart to me, and I have loved you for a thousand years. I love you for a thousand more.
All right. Yes. You did it again, Goosebumps. Yeah, goosebumps again.
That's good stuff.
Thank you very
much. This episode is brought to you by Fiji. More than just water.
This is not just rock. It's ancient volcanic rock that filters tropical rain, giving it double the electrolytes and its signature soft, smooth taste. It's not just water. It's Fiji water.
Very much, and we managed to do it without any lung butter.
Hey, that's a victory.
You didn't miss a beat, Kalen. You don't sound any different at all.
You guys are great together.
Great together. I like it. Great together. You guys are a great sync. Goosebumps again.
Is it easier? Seriously. Is it easier with your brother to develop that chemistry since you guys grew up together, or is it kind of the same where you try to find that chemistry?
You can match. Technically speaking, our voice is going to blend. Like, there's that whole sibling thing, so they naturally blend better. Yeah. But I think the work, the way, like, we taught, like, we learned each other's tricks. So we had more time with each other, but we didn't really start till we were both living in separate places. So you could get that kind of shorthand and connection with almost anybody. It's just we have the benefit of having the voice blend.
Yeah.
And then the hours you put in with people, you know, you look at tight harmony bands like, you know, the Eagles.
Simon and Garfunkel.
All those, like, they just practiced and practiced and practiced. And I think that's definitely the most important thing. Hard work always eclipses talent to me. You know, it's like the harder you work at something, the more time you put into it, the better you're going to be.
There are people who are naturally or super talented who do the thing, but if, you know, they're either stuck in their bedroom playing their scales better than anybody else, they don't know how to promote themselves, or, you know, their personality sucks. Whereas the guy who might technically not be as good is putting himself out there, showing up on time, being professional, and being genuine. The audience is going to like that more than the guy who can play a really fast Lydian domino fucking scale musical skate park.
And I would assume that in any band, you know, the rapport is so important.
Huge.
And being that you guys are brothers, you know, brothers fight left and right. So, you know, you get over the shit, it's the next day, whatever.
Oh, yeah.
So, like you were saying before you started, you know, you guys have the trust, you know, you're not going to fuck each other or anything like that.
Exactly.
So, I mean, it couldn't get any better. And the great thing about everything I've heard off the new album with you guys is the lyrics, because I'm a lyric guy.
Yeah.
So for me, like this whole therapy shit, I had a therapist, one out of 40, that was all right because he didn't ask me how my day was. Remember I was telling you? No, I really went to probably 40, 50.
Right.
As soon as they said, "How are you today?" Fuck you, see ya.
Yeah.
But the one I went to, remember I was telling you, he goes, "Well, what are you doing with that gold chain on your necklace? What do you think you're going to get anywhere in life like that?" and he said, he goes, "What the fuck is with that gold necklace?" And I said, "Okay, I'll come back."
Yeah.
And
not what you go to, like, you're not going to therapy to answer a question like, "How are you today?"
Yeah.
See, like,
I'm clearly fucked. I'm in fucking therapy.
That's why I'm here. I'm not asked to be here how my fucking day is.
Yeah.
You're supposed
help
to read
fix
me.
Yeah. Help fix me. Do something. I'm paying you.
Yeah.
Like, if you're going to ask someone how they are, you need to have investment in the answer. And, you know, if a therapist is asking you how you are, then
that's what they do.
That's just filling up time. I mean, there's some people who want, so some people might not feel validated at home or never got somebody. That could be the best thing for them.
I should say it for guys like us.
Yeah.
Including Rob.
Yeah.
That how your day shit doesn't work.
No, I want you to
yell at me.
Show me.
Swear at me and shit.
So I think the person I talked to is like, "So what's your problem?" And I was like, "Ah,
here we go."
So then I went in circles for a little bit. Then she found the things I said. I was ranting. It's like, "So do you want," then she's like, "Okay, well, if you feel like that, do you want to do that?" I'm like, "Okay, no." So that's clearly me just being emotional and idiotic. Okay, so we can, and so we just kind of started sifting through the cellar of despair and grossness that was my psyche, and we started putting the things that were real in the real pile, and the things that were bullshit in the bullshit pile, they weren't going away because it's a knee-jerk reaction. You know, it takes time. But to be able to see it like that, and that's the only... So I had a really... there was no, like, mushy bullshit. There was no...
What, you didn't do a Ben Affleck... Or no, excuse me, Matt Damon and Robin Williams. You didn't do that? You didn't do the It's Not Your Fault scene from Good Will Hunting with her?
I actually did that to her.
And she... And what made you pick that as a single?
So I have an affliction... Because that's I love that song. I'd never read the Twilight, never watched the movies. I'm old school.
Don't lie. You watched the movies.
I never did, buddy.
You watched all five.
I swear to God.
What, 20 of them?
I have no shame, and you know this by now.
That is true.
I've never seen a movie, never read a book. But that song, when I hear that song, not only do I like it, but I have to sing along. And I don't care where I am. And it's not like a quiet hum. By the time the chorus hits, I'm like theater boy. So I was in my kitchen, a buddy had come over, actually a guitar player for Vimic, Jed Simon, strapping young lad, some of you metal guys will know that. They put it on, and my wife was there, and Crystal, my manager, was there, and I was cutting some fucking vegetables, and so on. I'm like, son of a bitch, and I just start belting out the chorus. Little do I know, she was recording it, and she put it on TikTok. And I'd had a little success with singing my song Happy, which I didn't know I was being recorded with my buddy Paul. Got like 100,000+, you know, it was like, for me, it was great.
Sure.
This one is like 900,000.
Wow.
It blew up. It was just growing and growing and growing and growing. And I think like the 2 days later, whatever really started peaking, my brother texted me from California. He's like, you got to cut that. And
I was like, congratulations on your viral video. Now you get to cut the song.
And I disregarded that. And there are so many people.
What a nice brother.
Oh, he's the smart one. He was the one who got me into Korn. We'll talk about that later. But he said that and I ignored it. And there were so many like people on the comments. Oh, my God, I want to hear the whole version, please. And I was like, I wasn't against doing it. I just didn't have that on my radar. So he comes and visits to Nashville, and he sets up studio time. He says, "We're gonna lay down the,
I said we were going to the studio, and then when we got there, it was like, now we're gonna cut the song."
And so you had to get him into the studio, and it was like, you're not leaving until it's done.
Yeah. Well, you just put him in a room and tell and give him a song to do, and he'll make it happen.
Yeah,
that's kind of the thing. He won't say no, but if you know, trying to get him to plan it or anything like that,
and
I can imagine that.
No. Yeah, there was. I mean, everybody wanted it. Like, you know, my wife said it. My manager said it. I mean, it was going to happen, but it took him booking studio time with Zach. We laid down just the bare bones acoustic and some vocal stuff, played some synths, and then we played it for some people, and they were like, yes, this has to happen. It took a long time. I got a band that I play with a lot that live in Nashville with me called The Daily Fair. Two wonderful, wonderful broads. I think that's the proper thing. Hannah and Lissa.
Yeah.
And they're so amazing. They have great senses of humor. And so they did all the harmonies on it. So we did this cool kind of back and forth thing. Nick helped produce it. And we did it at Wild Feather Recording. And it sounds really fucking good.
That's so cool that you're working with your brother like this. Now, Nick, when you see Kalen come in, you know, you say, cut it, cut it, cut it. And then he performs it. What was it, everything you thought it would be when it was final, or even better?
Truthfully, the day that he did that, it was not happening. We had an hour left, and he wasn't happy with his vocal. He was getting a little over it, and he's like, maybe we'll just come back tomorrow or something. I think I was flying out. I was like, nah. And so I leaned in and I told Zach, hey, Zach, watch this. So I spent about 10 minutes just really laying into him, just getting under his skin.
he has that ability.
So I think he got a text message from somebody, and I'm like, okay, so now we're doing this instead of finishing the song.
Oh, so annoying.
Then I told him, I was like, you know what, man? You're right. You don't have it today. So we'll just go cut it tomorrow, you know? We can come back another day. And he's like, get in the room.
Get the fuck out of here.
Oh, he was so ticked. He was so angry. And Zach's like, what are you doing? And I'm like, watch.
Now, in a normal...
He nailed the next take.
Now, in a normal circumstance, if you see Kalen is, you know, he's just frustrated. It's just, today's not the day. Is that what you do? You just walk away and say, okay, look.
Generally, it's the best way to do it. Because I'm not a fan of seeing people do 10, 20 takes and... A lot of times what will end up happening, I produce vocalists, and they'll do it, they like to do it a bunch of times,
And half the time, the second take, or sometimes even the first take they did, is the best one. And then we'll start playing back, like, oh, I like that one. Which was that one? It's like the fucking second one you did. So if I don't think it's working, what I'll do is just take a break. I try to get it done in the allotted time. You know, sometimes you're working on deadlines. But there was just, I felt rushed initially but I wouldn't have done it. He got me in there, put me on the hot seat. And I was also, which we'll get into, was dealing with the beginning of all my vocal issues that I'm just getting over with. My sinuses and things like that. And so it was really difficult to get the big notes. And I wasn't used to having the strain. So I didn't know what was going on. So it was in my head, which he didn't know, nobody knew, I was confused and starting to get a little alarmed. It'd be like if you're like Nick, what's that thing about home run hitters? They have like a 400 something. You know, if you're a really good hitter.
Or like if you rip your Achilles, yeah, you're pretty much done.
But if you're like a person who, like, when they, like, if you drive the ball 300 yards and suddenly one day you're having a hard time hitting 200, you're going to be like, what's wrong with my body? What's right. happening to me? So that's where I was. But he pissed me off enough for me to throw all that to the wayside and jam it in there. And
well, you just didn't have your guy. You always talk about, like, when we go to the studio, we talk about our guy when we're going to sing
the character.
A song. Like, who are you playing? And I wasn't seeing it. So I was like, well, if I plumb him up and tick him off, he'll probably find his guy. Yeah.
And my guy wasn't at all pissed off. I was pissed off. So yeah. I created this really forlorn, like, gothic, romantic dude who I was the exact opposite of at that moment. What I wanted to do is smash Nick in the face.
Well, there was dynamic finally. Like, we weren't getting that. We weren't getting the gusto, as you like to say, at the end, like, especially with some of the bigger notes. Like,
we were sans gusto.
Yeah, it was just not. And I was like, well, we got to knock him around somehow because he's a vocal prodigy and he knows what he's doing. So the only way that I can help him with vocals is to help him find his guy or piss him off.
And he's good at both of those things.
And you were shook because before you could always hit that high note. So when you couldn't, because of the sinus issues, you were all thrown off.
Yeah.
Because you hadn't experienced anything like
nothing
that. I mean,
like
you
that.
Crushed it in here.
Yeah.
So, I mean, you know.
I appreciate that. I was right in the midst of my medical hell, but it was, you know, I started figuring out how to make the notes work in a different way when I didn't have the projection or the strength. So I just had to kind of change it up. While I was waiting to find out exactly what was wrong with me.
He's singing as well as he ever has as far as like the gigs we've done, the show that he, like the performance here.
Yeah,
he's
the
doing
surgeries.
Some of the best work that he's ever done, but it's odd for him.
I don't have the strength back yet. I'm still building that back up from all of
it. He's used to never being tired or never having to work on this because his voice is a very well-toned muscle. You know, like that's like he's lifted weights for 20 years is what the equivalent is. And so now it's a little more difficult for him, but it's the result of it's been good.
Yeah, we're back in action. It's only going to get better. So I'm very grateful for that.
And when you were with the bands, I forget which one it was that I was reading. They had said, hey, Kalen, when are you coming out with that soft song or whatever, right? They kept bugging you. And you said, as soon as I get off this tour, I'm gonna right?
Yeah. That Joey with Vimic was always saying, why are you doing the stuff you're writing, the acoustic stuff? And I was like, well,
I want fucking tour right
I'm
now.
Working. Yeah. And there was so much to do, but thank God he did. He was always super supportive of that. And he's like, don't waste your time at home, you know, playing with your pecker, go and record some stuff. And I started pulling out the old songs, working on new songs, got Nick back in the picture with that stuff, and then made it happen.
And that's so important to have, you know, somebody to give you the confidence like that to do that, right?
Absolutely.
How hard is it, you had an issue, right? You said the sinusitis or whatever it was, and that's why. But how hard is it for, like, just regular musician daily that to not lose their voice, I guess, or get fucked up? Because if they do, guess what? They can't perform, right? So how hard is it to keep, I guess, a healthy and B, not strain your voice?
So it starts off with your foundation, proper training, and if, let's say you're just a really naturally good singer, maintenance, taking care of your voice. I always tell people the things that are the worst for your voice is going to a loud club or a show and talking over the music. It's not doing death metal screaming. I can do that stuff properly and not hurt myself. But if I go to a place that's loud and I'm bellowing over the music, by the next day I feel that fatigue. And so I think training, doing your warm-ups, like I did warm-ups for years and years, started at opera, went to music school after that, was a vocal coach. So I'm doing warm-ups with my students all the time. So I don't really do warm-ups on my own unless I have a long, break, and now I'm doing stuff to rebuild my voice, all kinds of different things just to get the strength back. But do the work. It's just like you wouldn't go and bench press 300 pounds right away. Mm-hmm. You're going to start small, and you're going to do it right. You're going to learn form. You're going to learn how to, you're going to stretch. You're going to do all the things that will get you there. And once you get to the place that you're happy with what you're doing, then you're maintaining it, not doing stupid things, not, you know, not working out while blowing lines of cocaine, and, you know, and not drinking water. There's a lot of things. So you got to just be smart and put the work in.
Very interesting, because you've lasted the test of time, that's for sure. And now, Nick, had you guys been with a label, would you be able to still pick your own single, release it when you want to? This episode is brought to you by Let's Get Checked. Are you the man your father was? Recent studies have shown that men's testosterone levels have dropped substantially since the 1980s at about an average of 1% per year. Think about how old your father was when he was born. For example, if he was 30, your testosterone levels could be 30% lower than his. Low testosterone levels can have all type of health effects on men. It can affect your mood, sex drive, memory, muscle mass loss, you name it. And yes, low testosterone is more common the older you get, but it can affect men at any age. So let's talk about today's sponsor, Let's Get Checked. You can order a testing kit that will be delivered to you in a discreet packaging with next day delivery. Once your sample arrives in the laboratory, confidential results will be available from your secure online account within 2 to 5 days. So, if you want to test your hormone levels without having to leave your home, visit trylgc.com/MSCSmedia and get 25% off your test using the code MSCSmedia. The link is in the description at the top. This podcast is brought to you by Monster Energy. Tear into a can of the meanest energy drink on the planet, Monster Energy. It's the ideal combo of the right ingredients in the right proportion to deliver a big bad buzz that only Monster can. Monster packs a powerful punch, has a smooth, easy drinking flavor. Athletes, musicians, co-eds, road warriors, metalheads, geeks, hipsters, and bikers dig it. You will too. Monster Energy is more than just the green OG. Monster has Monster Ultra, Juice Monster, Monster Hydro, Rehab Monster, Dragon Tea, Monster Max, Muscle Monster, and many more. Buy on Amazon, buy on Walmart, or go to monsterenergy.com, and believe me, you'll find a place. Unleash the beast. Monster Energy.
So that all depends on what kind of deal you sign. You know, a label can be intricately involved in everything. I think last time you mentioned like the 360 deals.
Right.
Like certain labels will control entirely what comes out, and you know, you have an A&R person and you're at the behest of a label head and they get to pick what song they push to radio because they're the ones doing all of that. But if you have a deal that strictly involves distribution of what you make yourself, like I point to Garth Brooks was one of the first people that did it. After his initial contract expired, I think it was after his fourth album, he basically got and started an imprint that's called Pearl Records, and he re-signed with Capitol. But all the music came through Pearl Records, and so he owned his own masters, and he was basically licensing the music to the label to exploit. Now, he still had to talk to the label and discuss things with them. It led to him basically renting a semi, going to the factory and loading up the CDs of the seventh album, because he wanted to sell it for $15 and had 14 songs on it, and they wanted to sell it for $20. And he basically said, uh-uh. And so he took it, brought it to his house, and he's like, until we negotiate the price I want, I've got it.
Wow. And this is Garth, and we're talking about Garth Brooks here at this point on his seventh album. So he kind of paved the way with that maybe a little bit?
I think opened the door to that. Well, artists were empowered at that point more because, you know, during that time, you were... I mean, a legacy act at that point was selling CDs. They'd sold vinyl. They'd sold how many cassette tapes, because you know how long they lasted. So the units and numbers that were moving at that time were astronomical. I mean, Garth Brooks sold almost 100 million records in 10 years. It took the Beatles 40 years to do over that.
Garth Brooks is the man.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
That is. So it's wow. Garth, it's Springsteen for me, Tom Petty.
Tom Petty.
Eagles. Those are all big time artists for me, but like Garth was the first one, and I learned all about him and how he did the business. You know, it's like he was very determined to make sure that the fans got their money's worth.
That's
that
so cool.
He got his money's worth, and that the label didn't own him, so to speak. So it's more so prevalent cool. now than it was. But I mean, back yeah. then you were, I mean, the label gave you an advance, $250,000, right? Or $1 million, and you had to pay that back. So you had artists selling a million records, and they hadn't made any money
because they had to pay it all back.
Yeah. Correct. Well, they're only getting, and the deal that they negotiated basically allowed them to get 20 cents per record towards their advance because everything else got taken up for packaging fees promotion. And
oh, yeah. Totally. It was they're a total, yeah. I mean.
Do you think it's possible today to sell 100 million records?
No.
Impossible with the streaming and everything else.
Well,
right?
You're going to get, I mean, you're going to get billions of downloads and views and all that stuff. We're seeing that. There's a lot of songs that have over a billion views. But those kind of numbers, because people don't buy physical copies of things in mass anymore, aren't a thing, you know?
Right. So if you get however many views, it doesn't equal out if you had sold 100 million actual records physical.
Right.
Because they're giving you peanuts on the
but yeah the good thing is that if you're smart, basically you own your own stuff, and what still happens is people buy stuff at live shows. So as long as you control your merchandise and you're out there selling your own stuff, you're making better money as an artist on that than you were back in the day, for sure.
Yeah, that's great advice for guys that are coming up, Nick.
How does it work with like TikTok now and Instagram, when you hear like a song, you know, you can use a song. Does the artist get paid for that? Do you guys know that answer? I was always wondering that.
So there is potential for revenue depending on how it's licensed. So basically what you have is online distribution companies that that put you on all the places. Like you upload your song to the internet.
Mm-hmm.
This is fun for Kalen. So Kalen, you upload your song to the internet.
Okay, step one.
Yep, and then they basically put it. Yep, he's done. They put it everywhere for you. These companies basically have put it Spotify everywhere in the world. Like any music company, any streaming company, they make it available for Instagram and stories, and you get paid quarterly. I think the last time I looked at mine, I put a song out like 3 years ago, and I think I looked at after the first quarter, and I think 6 people had paid for it at that point. So I got like $6.
And you probably got a fucking million streams.
And, you know, so there is money, but it's just not a lot. And as an artist, the decision that you have to, you have to basically have a talk with yourself and go, okay, Spotify is a tool and it's sweet if 100,000 people listen to my song, but guess what? That's not going to get you. You'll get some money, but it's not a lot. I mean, we had the drama with Taylor Swift taking her stuff off Spotify, blah, blah, blah. I mean, you know, in the podcast world, you know, you have all of the drama concerning Joe Rogan's status on Spotify.
Neil Young left.
Yep, all of that. Jesus. But it isn't that is not about the money. That is actual, like, to me, it's important social media. You know, you can say what you want about Facebook, Instagram, TikTok, stuff like that, but Spotify is where music gets made, and it's the most useful social media tool as far as playing your songs. You know, it's like that's still a good thing, but it's not a source of income. It's not a revenue stream. You have to look everywhere for that.
The good thing is they bought a microphone. I think it's called Megaphone. And that's basically everything that YouTube is.
Mm-hmm.
All the analytics, monetization, all that other stuff. And the guy I deal with, he said they're doing the overhaul in January 23. So I think all that will change. The monetization.
Really?
The, what is it, the CPM or RPM?
Yeah.
Which is how much you get paid per play, right?
Yeah. Letters. It's definitely letters.
Letters, yeah. Like it's either CPM or RPM.
I mean, if that's happening, that's going to be interesting. Because, I mean, YouTube is, if you can get YouTube monetization, that is potentially decent revenue. Like that, you start getting into money that makes some sense, you know, especially if you can continue to get the
double entendre, Nick. Sense. Nice.
But yeah.
See, I don't see it on YouTube without sponsors, but maybe it's
different.
Right,
well, that's the whole thing is, like, it leads to that. You know, it's like getting that YouTube monetized, like having your channel monetized.
That expands you to other things. But YouTube isn't giving you shit.
No.
They're horrible. But the sponsors do.
But it's just like, I mean, it's like Spotify. You don't get anything per se. But if you've got that backing and you have those numbers, first of all, it looks good to people who are trying to book you. They like that. You know, you send them your money, or so you send them your info. They like the idea that 30,000 people have heard your record. Hopefully that means that, you know, in a club, hopefully that means 100 people will show up to your show. That's the idea. So it's like, right. It's a tool, but it's not like back in the day when it's like, okay, they sold 2 million records their first week out, you know, like that.
Yeah. You're depending on merchandise, right?
100%, well, merchandise, I mean, vinyl and CDs actually grew in sales last year.
Vinyl had its biggest year last year.
Yeah. It's gone up 3-4 years in a row. I mean, people are doing that. They're doing special pressings, and even CDs increased. More CDs were purchased last year than there were the year before, which
really?
I never thought I'd see again.
Wow.
People are doing but it's different now. It's you know, it's not like
it's boutique. Well, yeah. We talked about this before. Like the way that, I mean, people are, you're going to see tapes, like cassette tapes, and it's never going to be as big, but records are growing, and eventually CDs are going to be growing, and car companies are going to start giving you options to put a CD player in your car, and it might not last forever, but you're going to see a spike in it because the generation that's acquiring this stuff is like, oh, wait, the internet's boring and uncool now. I want to have like a physical copy.
Yeah.
And their parents will be like, that's what I was saying, you rat bastard.
Yeah.
So,
or maybe if somebody gets grounded and they go buy a physical copy, they're like, wow, you're fucking growing up, son.
Yep.
Right?
Here's your computer back. I don't need it, Dad. Right. I'm listening to this Shakira record.
It's fun to hold something in your hand.
Oh,
you know?
Yeah.
I mean, it's why I have, like, I mean, I don't think that, you know, the generation after us, I mean, I'm right between the Gen X millennial thing. I'm 82. So it's
me
like
too. I'm 82
yeah,
too.
Except we're like, we don't fit perfectly in either one, no. But we understand both. But we know that, like, there's a value in that thing that you like. I just watched High Fidelity with John Cusack the other night. We did.
That was good.
Oh, yeah.
And he's like, what you like? Books, music, movies. These things matter. And it's like, when you walk into someone's house and you see a collection of books or DVDs or CDs, yeah. It says a lot about who they are and what they're into.
I agree.
And I like that.
You know what I loved about the albums? I couldn't wait to go get the CDs so I could go through the pages.
Yep. Yeah.
That's what I wanted.
The lyrics were in there.
Yeah, yeah, the lyrics.
There's lyrics.
Yeah.
I would be opening the thing with the cellophane on the way to the car.
Me
never
too.
Never litter.
And right, remember the top of it? You'd have to pick the corner.
Oh, yes.
And it was always a bitch to get that off.
It's like getting into Fort Knox or a little in high school.
Yeah,
it's like having sex for the first time was easier than this. All the work I did to have sex, I'm still opening the fucking CD.
Well, it's funny because like I'm 85, so I'm the millennial, I guess. And my kids, you know, I don't know what they're considered
Gen Z,
but like everything is starting to go backwards. Meaning like fanny packs are like cool again.
Yep.
I'm like fanny yep. packs, what the fuck?
It's like, cyclical.
Yeah.
It's like, I don't think it's forward or back. I think it's pendulous, but really things just revolve.
Cycle.
In yeah. cycles. And I mean, we've kind of evolved, and now with media, we've gone so far.
Yeah.
And things are happening so fast that we didn't realize, I don't think people had a clear vision of how cyclical everything is. Like, because, you know, in the 1500s, it's like, you know, leeching is very popular. And then it took a few hundred years, and then it got big in the 80s or 1800s again. Like, we were using, like, decades and sometimes centuries for things to cycle through. With where we are now with technology, we're seeing it in a few years.
Yeah.
We're seeing things, like, rise and fall and then come back again. So it's a fascinating thing, and it's not necessarily a bad thing if we understand the pattern.
Yeah.
And we can be like, okay, yeah, I don't need to be jumping from place to place. I can hold on to what I like and what I'm about. And just like real estate markets, like, yes, if I bought this house, oh no, the market went down, it'll be back up. Hold on.
Just relax.
Just yeah. fucking relax, people.
Yeah.
Last podcast, we were all about kindness. This podcast, fucking relax.
Hey.
Oh, it's gotten yeah. absolutely okay. fucking crazy.
We got to tell people to relax, Nick. That's our mission.
Oh, I thought you were going to go the opposite of kindness, so I was teeing up to go, hey.
No, I'm saying relax is the new
relax
mantra.
Is good. I like it.
Thank you. I'm glad you approve, you prick.
It's funny because, like I said, with the CD thing, like my Jeep has a CD player, so I still
nice.
Have some CDs.
Nice.
But I was jamming out the other day to Green Day Basket Case, and like my son looks at me, he goes, I know this song. And I'm like, how the fuck do you know Green Day? He's like, it was on Stranger Things. And I'm like, oh my God. So they pick it up from the shows even, like, because there'll be little, what was that old song by that lady that's now huge?
Oh, it's Running Up the Hill by
Kate
Bush.
Yes.
Kate Bush, yeah.
Every kid singing that song, like.
Yeah, wow, which is really exciting. But think about, like, when I watched, the Shining.
Yeah.
I found out about Wendy Carlos, the composer, and got a bunch of stuff. I mean, here's to you, Mrs. Robinson, from The Graduate. You know, like, it's always, media is always cross-pollinated, and we learn things from it. Like, what's that cool thing? And I'm so grateful for things like Shazam, because I found a bunch of great, like, music,
oh, yeah,
like, all these great things that I'm like, what the fuck is that? And then Shazam tells me, like, that's the Star Trek future that I like, which I... Once again, people, you're gonna have to take the bad with the good. So fucking relax, all right? Don't, if you don't bitch about Facebook. Just don't get on it. Use your Shazam and shut up.
A lot of it going back, even though I know Netflix has fucked a lot of people with deals, their documentaries are really good.
Oh yeah,
and a lot of people watch them, and I think a lot of people watch those documentaries, and I think this is just my opinion, and I think that kind of brought us back to, like, our time, like, because, like you said, me and you were in that middle thing.
Yep,
like, we understand it, but we were raised old school.
Yeah,
you know,
well, so it's like the computer came, the computer lab existed, and then, like, in the fifth or sixth grade, I think I got a computer in the classroom. That's what it, like, right? It
was
like
the apples with the colored apples.
Yeah. Yep, Jeff with Oregon Goldblum. Trail and stuff.
Oh,
and
then my if God. You had best game ever,
oh, yeah. best game ever. And if you had, like, a rich friend, they had the car phone.
Oh,
right.
Yeah. And, yeah,
and if anybody with a wire, like a big, you yeah. know, and the Cadillac, you're yeah. like, yo, can yeah. we take Franco's car? You know, nowadays yeah. they have. That's all you see these people on is a phone.
Yeah. 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 And that's, but there is, when I was still teaching a lot more, and I was teaching some younger students, this is by now like 7 years ago, there was this kind of like the 13, 14 year olds then were being like, yeah, I got to take a break from the social media things. And I think that there's already kind of a sea change happening where it's not cool anymore. It's not new. It's their existence. So, they're going to stay on it because it's convenient, but I think there's becoming, I think that's why CDs are coming back and other things are coming back because, oh, wait, I don't need to use this kind of technology for everything in life. There's an outside with tangible things you can touch.
As long as they're not severely addicted.
Yeah. I mean, with anything, like I've heard.
The first generation that does anything. Like, so anytime,
we always fuck it up,
like,
the first time.
The first generation, well, we as humans have to learn.
We have to adapt, right?
We learn and adapt. And so the first time, anybody who gets something brand new isn't going to know how to do it. But kids have watched, like kids today have grown up with social media and they understand what's good about it and what's bad about it. I was amazed at, I went to work at Trader Joe's late last year and I hadn't really worked in a place with like younger kids very much.
Probably, ever. What the fuck?
And I was amazed at the way that they understood things. Like, I really enjoyed working with these kids. They were interesting. They had a cool perspective. Like, it was completely the opposite of what I thought it was going to be.
See, I already said that. Right when you said, I said, I bet they were all fucked up.
Nope, and it was, I found the opposite.
That's what
but you thought the same thing as me, right?
Oh, I walked in. Yeah. It was just like, okay, I'm going to go work at a grocery store. I'm almost 40 years old and I'm working with 18-year-old kids. And I thoroughly enjoyed them all. And their perspective was interesting. And not only that, it was like we were able to communicate positively. You know, like, I mean, a hilarious example was I had a girl walk in, sit down in the break room and go, I hate Joe Rogan. And then I had a guy walk in and goes, I love Joe Rogan. And I said to both of them, I was like, you know what? Honestly, here's the deal. And I said to the girls, like, you don't hate Joe Rogan, but you hate certain things that have happened on Joe Rogan's show, possibly. But he himself, you don't have any reason to hate because just like anybody else, Joe Rogan is doing a thing. Mm-hmm. Are you going to agree with all of it? No. But what he does is he allows people to come on and speak their minds.
Absolutely.
You
know? Really.
And so when you and she's like, I don't hate Joe Rogan. You're right. I said, we got a song later on.
That.
We got a song later on that there's a line in it that will make a lot of sense.
Our other original we're going to play for you. It kind of ties into that.
And if we can bring it back to that where, okay, you hate Joe Rogan, I like him, but we could still go have dinner.
Yep.
Right.
Just like with all the political bullshit.
Yep.
That's
yep.
how it should be. If I'm red, you're red, blue, who gives a fuck? Okay, we disagree on that, but who cares?
Yeah.
It's turned into sports is the problem.
Yes,
politics has
correct.
Turned into sports, and that is an issue.
A real issue.
Yeah.
And so we have to, that's something we all have to back off on and realize that it's not about who you vote for, it's about how you act. Yeah. Also, if you truly want to vote, talk to me about who the mayor of your town is, who your city councilman is, who's your representative in Congress. That's the stuff that matters.
That's why I don't do politics, because I don't know But I, you know what? If there's a pothole on my street, I'll just fix it. I'll just fix it myself.
Just go out and pour some concrete on it. Yeah, that's yeah.
Which
that's
is why I got arrested.
My thing is, I was like, this was not supposed to be about, you know, rooting for the Patriots.
Yeah, but you said it best. And the cool thing is, I always expect, because I hear a couple horror stories, and I've experienced a couple horror stories. But then, those are the loud things that we see, and those are the loud things that go viral. But then, my brother here in a break room, makes a good point, and people with different opinions just listen, and they're like, "Oh yeah, I'm and thinking about it in a different way, not trying to change opinions, right, but presenting a wider view." And it was pleasant, and that's
how it should be,
yep, every time.
Because what are humans without debate and contrast? You know what? Yeah. What
we'd
that's
be boring
not human.
If we were all the same.
You're dumb, surround yourself with smart people. When you're smart, surround yourself with smart people who disagree with you.
Right, and like you talked to that employee and changed their mind. Right. Well, that also goes with innovation too, because how can you progress without any type of debate, argument to come out or invent, you know, great things.
Yeah.
Right?
If we all agreed, it would be boring as hell.
Yeah. Well, yeah.
Well, that's what they want. Yeah, they want everybody to go to the government and be like, hey, I need you for this,
be
that.
Boring
blah,
as
blah.
Hell. It'd be boring as hell.
You gotta have some, being able to see it from other people's perspectives allows for the best, I mean, if I got my way, every song I did would be a suicide, slow, gothic, like, it would be cool. I'd be happy.
Not lying.
But nobody else would be happy. And so somebody with a different perspective who likes different things, our mission is generally to show each other different things, musically, movies, ideally, like with our, you know, we both learn from each other, and we're kind of the perfect litmus test, because we used to fight, we were so different, and still are, but we've kind of branched into this cool thing, and we're a great team because we come from different places with different thoughts. And when we get heated and it starts happening, we take it back. One of us always apologizes, the other one then does. Like, it can fire off for a second. Then we're like, okay, you know, here's why I flew off the handle. When you said it like that, I wanted to stab you. And that's, I know you didn't mean that. I'm in my period.
No. Yeah, yeah, yeah. And I think what we're all saying is just, everybody's just have an open mind.
Yeah.
Don't be
yeah.
dead set. Yes. You know, just have an open mind, hear somebody out. Who knows? Yep. Might change your whole damn life.
Show up with the, like, I don't need to defend an idea. I don't need to defend something I think is correct. I need to understand why someone else may think it's not and understand their perspective. That's how I get somewhere.
Yeah, because maybe you're wrong, right? I'm wrong.
Well,
yeah.
There's very few things I'm 100% sure about.
Yeah, me too.
Very few.
Me too.
And it's amazing because there's so many, like, certain things, like... typical things. You see, like, a person, a young person go, like, push over an old guy in a walker. Like, that's not right. You don't do that. Like,
no.
You understand that's wrong. You know, there's certain things we know it's wrong.
Universal truths.
Correct.
And don't do it. Tried and true. It's like, well, the simple ideas of, you can take almost every religion has a version of it, or even the philosophies, non-religious philosophies. It's basically, be kind. To your neighbor, treat people how you want to be treated. Like, there's a million...
Kind to self and others.
Yeah,
That's our mom.
So
that's our mom. Talking,
yeah,
right?
So, like, you start off, like, first off, you know, if you don't like yourself, and everybody has insecurities, but if you're so out of alignment with who you are, you're going to be a dick. Yeah. And so it's like, that's why, you know, I used to be like, I'm never going to, no therapy, none of this. I already tried religion for a bit. Screw all that. I do it myself. And after a little bit, I was like, I need something, because I'm trying to suck my own dick, and I'm rolling around the carpet, getting nowhere. So it's like, you have to, and you can do it on your own. You can do it. People do it with meditation. There's a million ways, but you got to start here and figure out what your deal is, then come to terms with it, and then grow from there. And that's how you wake up in the morning and realize that all I really want to do today, whatever happens, is make sure whoever I come in contact with is a little better off, you know, than before they saw me. Like, if I can spread joy, make somebody laugh, that's awesome. Then, like, karma, because I found out about karma, then karma owes you, and then you can reap the benefits, karma. And then you can use that to fuck your enemies.
Did
I blow it at the I was so close, guys.
Now, you, real quick, Tommy, you two being brothers, right?
Yeah.
Who's older? Okay.
He's 18 months older than me, so I'm kind of in the same boat. I'm December 83.
Oh,
he's...
you gave your mom a hell of a headache.
Oh,
you
yeah.
two and...
Oh,
almost like Irish twins, right?
Irish twins, yeah.
So, growing up, do you guys like the same type of music? Are you more
not
of like country, grunge?
All.
What was, yeah.
Nick, so when I was about 8 and Nick was 10, we moved to Washington from L.A. and Northeast
Washington.
Now,
we grew up listening to what our parents listened to up to that point, and they showed us everything. And classical. We were very much a musical family, so we were all, we didn't really have opinions on music until around about 10 years old.
He got into country, and since he got into country,
oh, man.
I did not get into country, and I started going down the, hard rock, metal, the darker the better, the heavier the better. And I was still listening to my classical and other things. And even then, even through all of, we were dead set and not really getting along, I was full-blown goth, and he had a mullet and cowboy boots, looked good. And he still managed to show me Garth Brooks live in Central Park, and it's undeniable. And I sat there, I was like, no, you're right, this is awesome. And that, it was a lot harder back then, but no, we always went the opposite way of each other.
We would find things that we liked that were in common. We were brothers, and there was competition. I mean, and it was a thing where I started making music, and then of course he starts making music. And I was like, really? This is supposed to be my thing. And I was like, I was the oldest. Like, he was in the way. And I mean, I took it seriously, and I was very much, we were in a small town, so I was making the music that everyone around the town liked. And I started doing it because I wanted to. I wanted the girls to think I was cool. Like, and I was too small to play football, and I wasn't quite good enough to play basketball, and I couldn't see shit, so I couldn't play baseball. So I was like, what am I going to do? And then the music teacher said you had a good voice. And I was like, okay, I'm going to do this. So I did that, and I sat in my room for years and just played the guitar and learned 200 songs by the time I was 18. But,
well, congratulations.
Thanks.
And then this guy pops up.
Oh, there was a moment. It was like I was upstairs showing my mom and dad something. He came up, and he started trying to play. And I wiped the floor with him.
Just shit the bed all over the place. I was dumb.
And so this is what happened. His dad says, go back downstairs and keep practicing. 6 months later, he came up and wiped the floor with me and never looked back. Like, he just...
six hours a day.
Yeah, he was determined. And so when we, I graduated, I got out of it. I moved, went to community college. He stuck around, caused all kinds of problems in the town.
No way.
Yeah.
Yep.
Then we end up in California a couple of years later, and where we first bonded musically for real was Tom Waits.
Yep.
Oh wow.
So it was early Tom Waits
and Mule Variations. Yep. And
so it's like I show him this, and it was like we were at that point we had written, I think we'd written one song together.
Yeah.
We'd started Happy.
Yeah. Well, yes.
We did a version of Happy at that point. That was like the first thing that we ever wrote together was Happy.
Pretty much. There's a couple little things here and there, but yeah, we had the chorus.
Yeah, that's right.
I love that song.
And so I liked the Tom Waits, but it was all kind of the more like 70s, like singer-songwriter, Randy Newman, Bob Dylan-y. It was still he had the voice. Christmas 2002, almost 20 years ago, he buys me Blood Money, which is that record that just came out. It's like a pirate in hell. Yeah. It's like weird. And it was like I was like, this record is what's inside my brain.
Right.
And the fact that he gave it to me, like, our relationship was always fine and good. We were different people, but I was like, you get me. And there was like kind of an artistic trust that happened at that point. I was like, okay.
We met
Very
there
cool.
and that sort of informed the rest of what we did. We'd gotten into a couple other individual songs together, and we played a bit, and it was like, but that was the beginning of it. Was we met at Tom Waits for real the first time, and everything else started happening.
Yeah, he's smart. He realized he had to, like, that's kind of extreme. Like, that's an extreme genre. It's very experimental and strange, and I love that stuff. And he's like, okay, how can you take what you love about that and make it sound like not just a 80-year-old man on a boat drunk?
With like a silver microphone with the wind blowing.
Yeah. I wanted to do all that. God, so we on business. And it's how do we take that, more? And so we started pulling these. So pulling from your extreme likes, like he does that with certain songs that I loathe, like some pop country things and things like that. I appreciate their quality and I understand, but there's things that don't resonate with me. But he takes elements of the things that he loves and brings it into the table, and I bring my thing. And now we write songs. It takes like 30 minutes to an hour to get the bones of a song.
That is so cool. And your brothers.
Yeah.
That's what makes it even cooler.
Oh, yeah. It's a fun thing to walk into a place, play a song, or just sometimes go into a bar and people are like, you guys twins? Irish twins. The parents, they did not waste time. And she didn't cry, though. It just kept doing it. Well, she said, this is your dollar.
Ben Affleck might need a therapist himself on top of other things. He just married Lopez again.
I don't know, man.
I'm rooting for him.
Dude, that made me kind of happy.
I'm rooting for him. I'm rooting for him, but...
I mean, it seemed like a...
Good move.
I don't know how much fucking alimony he's paying right now, but...
he's fine.
He'll be okay. I think... Like, I'm just worried about...
He's probably you left me for... I'm Alex Rodriguez.
Yeah.
My back is the size of a door.
He really is a large gentleman.
Very large. Very large.
See, I want to. Then you know what? Me and A-Rod have a feud now. Because I'll think of something. 1 second. I don't like the cut of his suits. Yeah. A-Rod, what's your deal?
I don't know. They're pretty perfectly.
Yeah, they are actually. I got nothing.
You
got
to find something better.
All right. Yeah. Batting competition.
I don't know what you define. I've met him quite a few times.
Batting competition. Yeah, him against me. And then at the end of it, I'll be like, wow, you beat a disabled person. Then I win.
So then you win.
She definitely looks better than him now, though. He's like balding and he's getting fat looking.
He's enjoying his retirement. And,
yeah, I think so.
Good for him. Good for him.
Absolutely.
So a lot of times I've seen, and actually the Happy, I believe, or maybe it was Good Times, one of the two. Why is it a lot of times like artists, they'll hold on to a track, maybe that's 10 years ago. It was written, you know, you did it for whatever reason, you decided not to release it. And then 10 years later, which you would think would be, you know, out of the time period because things are just moving so quick. Why a lot of times artists go, like yourselves, go back to a track that you wrote 10 years ago?
So... One of the good things is if a song sounds good 10 years later, if there's an aspect of the song, and it was the chorus is what we had, and there was different, and the story was there, and we were working on it sounding good, but I was touring and things like that. But the big thing is if it's good, you remember it.
Yep.
Two, and I don't record my stuff like on a voice thing. Like I get it in my head and I work it out and I'll play it a couple times. And if I don't remember it the next day, no worries. It's not good enough. But to come back to that chorus, I was just sitting alone. I called him up. I was like, dude, Happy. And to come back to it, was like, wow, that chorus still sounds good. So I'm not saying it like I've written a timeless piece of art, but something that can transcend time and be good all those years later. That's something you have lightning in a bottle. So it's a confidence boost saying, okay, if I still like this chorus, all right, let's take the idea we have and work those verses in and it's good. A lot of times it's just you write a song and it doesn't get it's like 98% there and it's magic, but if it doesn't get that last bit or if some life happens, things come up, songs sometimes get shelved and sit around. I mean, during pre-production for certain things, like when I was doing Vimic, like we wrote 40 songs. For the first, and we chose 11 of them or 12 of them.
Well, you cut 20, didn't you?
We cut all of them pre-pro style, and yeah, we did cut 20 songs for the record.
You cut 20 songs for the record, and then you narrowed it down after.
So now you got, and that's why you get, which I love, especially with CDs, is like, oh, the Japanese import of this has like that track that wasn't on the American release.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, they used to do the bonus tracks.
Bonus tracks.
So you would go buy the 11-track album, you want the cover,
yep,
and then you come out with the bonus with, say, 10 more songs with a whole new cover. You're back at, what was the store we used to always go to? They closed to get CDs.
Sam.
This episode is sponsored by Aurora. Do you know what the fastest growing crime in America is? For years, this crime rate has been surging and affecting millions of Americans. I'm talking about identity theft, and there's a new victim every 14 seconds. Yet despite this, those who have had their identity stolen are often shocked when it happens. That's why I'm excited to partner with Aurora, who is sponsoring this video. Aurora is identity theft protection, fraud monitoring, a VPN, password management, and antivirus software all into one easy-to-use app. Their VPN allows you to stay anonymous online by keeping your browsing history and personal information safe and encrypted. Protect you and your family from America's fastest-growing crime. Try Aurora for free for 2 weeks and see if you or anyone in your family's personal information has been compromised. Start your free trial today. Go to aurora.com/MSCS. The link is in the description below.
Goody. Tower Records.
I was called Camelot. I don't
remember. Camelot. Yeah. Camelot.
I think that was because Sam Goody and like there was a chain of music stores like Sam Goody, Musicland,
Hastings,
Camelot.
Circuit City.
I mean, you had all
FYI.
That.
Yeah.
I think though with song like so for artists or musicians or songwriters, we both hate it when people call themselves artists.
Like, I like it when you say it because you're the listener. You judge what art is. I'm just a builder. We build songs.
That's the idea. So basically you punch, like, it's just like work construction. You punch a clock, you accomplish what you're going to do, and then you move on. Now, the issue is that just because we accomplish and write a perfect song doesn't mean that we have the means or the need to cut it and record it at that point.
Yeah.
Right. You know, it may not be the right thing to come out.
Yeah.
We have a backlog of material that's not recorded that is, in my opinion, really just as good as what we've recorded. But it's just,
it takes time, you know.
And you have to group things together, figure out what's going on.
Yeah.
And so you kind of just have to trust the process. Also, what happens is, in a lot of cases, people get bored with playing. Like, you hear people complain about having to play the same song over and over again, so they get tired of it, or they don't want, or they also will, like, drown it because they don't want to let it go. Like, it's like, this song is,
they just kill it.
This song is so important.
Yeah.
It's so important to
reduce it to death. Then it's never perfect.
Yep.
We're dead set against that. And I, the mind of an engineer and a producer, and I work with engineer, producer, and mixer of the record, Phil English, is the patience. He's so fun. But like, and then Zach Kasich, who I recorded this with, and
can you pull up tattoo?
Yep.
So like, those guys, they can sit and they will spend the hours. Now, there's a line where they both say, it's like, I don't want to obsess and beat this thing to death, you know, or do anything like that. But I will let things go because I don't have the mindset for it. I want to create and move on. I leave it. And sometimes to detriment.
Once he's done cutting a song, like once he's done singing it, he forgets it.
I have to relearn it. It's gone.
Literally forgets it. Rarely does he need to have a lyric sheet in front of him in the studio or anything like that. But once that's done recording, he has to relearn it.
So then when you go on tour, you have to memorize it all again?
I just relearn the stuff and play it and practice, you know, and things like that.
But it's a conscious thing that he has to do. Like, I'm always amazed by that because it's like, we did this song 3 weeks ago. And he's like, yep, we're finished now and I have to relearn the lyrics now.
Yeah.
All right.
Because I have songs that are 15 years old in my head. I need all the room because I haven't recorded them yet. So I don't want to, so all the space that is, once it's recorded, I don't need it in here.
No.
And then learning it as a show and as a live song, not as a piece that I've constructed for the studio, so it goes into a different place in my brain. You know, like, I could still probably sing some Korn songs to memory, a couple maybe. And as Nick was saying, you know, how some people get bored. Like, I love what Korn did because I played a buttload of shows with them for the few years I was there, and we played Blind, their first sing. And I always loved that Jonathan Davis never spoke a lot. He didn't say a lot of things. And he had, initially, like, he barely spoke at all, but he had one time where he said, "What the fuck is up?" Got the crowd pumping as the drums start, ding, ding, ding. And the gist of his spiel every time was, this song is why we're here today. And this is, because he knows the fans want it. And he kind of painted the song in a light where he reminded not just the audience, but himself and us. It's like, this is why... this is why I'm getting paid to be here. This is why they have a massive career.
Yeah.
And so you come at it, and that kept it alive, I think. And then, you know, you can always change things up live. Like, Fieldy, the bass player, used to play the bass line for Too Many Puppies during the... and I would go, "Too Many Puppies" from Primus. So you do little things to zazz it up, you know, have fun with it, use it. Like, there's ways of not getting sick of your song. And if a song has made you a butt ton of money... and I love Radiohead, but like, their aversion and hatred of the song Creep, it's like, I understand, guys, but why don't you just like Kid A it a little bit, or like, you know,
remix,
like,
put
some remix,
do something,
it's bitching about it,
because
there's
a lot of people who like it, and I know they're not doing it on purpose, and they don't care, so it's all good. But like, I used to do this, like, when I put out a song, because I'm very critical, and somebody was like, "I really liked it," and I was like, "Oh, that's crap." And I'm like, what a dick. Taking, so it's like, it'd be like, "Hey," I would never do that if somebody said, "Oh, dude, I want to go to like Panda Express." I'm like, "That place is stupid and it sucks." Like, or, "Oh, I love this jacket. I hate those jackets." Like, why? What? That's a useless opinion.
Don't say anything.
Yeah. Now, if you say, "Hey, what do you think of this?" I'm always like, "Not my thing, but you're making it
good
work
for
man.
You, right?"
Yeah.
See, like, my thing is, I want to, like, when someone likes something, I am immediately inspired to attempt to like it, because if I like them and it makes them happy, and I get a chance to enjoy it with them, that's an experience I'm never going to have again.
I just bury my judgment deep inside.
And you want to understand why they like it, Nick?
I want to understand why, and I also, it's like, if I can like something else, that's better than not liking something else. So if someone being heavily into something helps me enjoy it at that moment. I might never ever listen to it again or do it again or eat it again, but them being happy is enough a lot of times for me to enjoy it with them.
And I see a lot of artists now, you know, maybe they do like the 40 song cut and then, you know, the album might be 12 or 15 and then they'll put the other, say, 25 on YouTube. And then they see how it does.
Yeah.
And then you'll see it on the next album 2 years later.
There's all kinds
of ways. A lot of times. And that's a pretty cool way to do it.
That's funny. And I think we brushed on this last time. It's like, there was this gloom and doom. It's like, there's no more CDs. We're never going to sell a million records. And yeah, I wish we were in the 90s right now. And I wish that I was doing this. I wish I was 20 years old in 1994 and just get all that time while it was, you know, my deal might have sucked, but I'd be knee deep in drugs and I would be all over the place and fine. But the world has changed and we should change with it. So the idea that I can
find a way.
Put a song on this fucking song is because I did a TikTok video without my knowledge.
Like, and it's fantastic.
And that's all that.
It's as good as Happy. And you know how much I like that one.
Yeah, I appreciate Happy that.
I don't know how many times I told you I liked it.
Yeah, that's a great
song. Ad nausea, probably.
That's a cool thing now. I'm like, hey, Kalen, if you can't handle the compliment, then just go slam your dick in the fucking bathroom door.
You probably should.
It's funny how you're doing this. Like, I went to see, and this is years ago, I like Rascal Flatts.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
Oh, they're awesome.
So I love them. I've seen them like seven
Kenny
times.
Kenny Chesney.
Yeah. And I'll never forget. Like you go for the same songs, absolutely, right? Your typical songs you like from there.
You had me.
And then what they did was they, at the one point in the you know, like get a break, guys probably, you know, need water and stuff like that. And the lead singer got up on stage and he just looked at the crowd and I think the drummer was just hit, or the guitar, somebody was doing something. They're like, don't stop believing. And then they just had like the whole place to sing it. They're not even singing at this point. They're just holding the mic out and everybody's doing it. And they were able to break it up. It was just so much fun. Not their song, of course, but
live
everybody knows that song.
That's just a great way of keeping
the audience. Like, if anyone's going to sing Don't Stop Believing, let Gary sing.
Yeah.
I got a great Rascal Flatts story.
I thought Rascal Flatts was the singer.
No, it's okay, buddy. Okay. There's there three of them in Rascal Flatts. No, so... So there was an up-and-coming, quote-unquote, country artist that got called into his label head's office, and he'd had two decent hit singles, and he heard they wanted to play him a song, and they said, we want you to cut this. And this guy goes,
I don't really think this is my sound.
Yeah, this is what he says. And he's like, I'm not going to... So he basically refuses to cut it, and they go, okay. The song... was Bless the Broken Road.
Oh, I was just gonna say that. Like, I was just gonna say to you, Nick. I was gonna say the one that got me hooked on Rascal Flatts was Bless the Broken.
God bless the broken.
God, that got me hooked.
It's a beautiful song.
So I bet guy wants to jump off a cliff.
Yeah. Oh, he never had another hit.
Yeah,
he's on the cliff. Yep. Believe me.
So I was actually Rascal Flatts is
Hammer
helped me understand one of the most beautiful things about pop music. It was a glaring example. Their very first song is a song called "Praying for Daylight."
Yep, praying for daylight.
Yeah, wait. So it's this upbeat dun dun dun. Yep. Like, it's just this happy poppy sound in the song. The lyrics to that song are, "I've got the lights turned up, the doors locked, the bedroom TV on, doing the only thing that gets me through the night since you've been gone. I'm praying for daylight, waiting for the morning sun so I don't act like my whole life is going wrong. Baby, come back to me, I swear I'll make it right. Don't make me spend another lonely night playing for daylight." It's the saddest freaking lyric I've ever heard in my life.
But it's
you
uppity.
Don't even know. Yeah.
But at least it's lyrics.
Yeah. Yeah.
Nowadays, you're lucky to get real lyrics.
That's
what's so great
man.
About what you're you guys are doing.
That's my old man thing. It's like, I understand. Now, I love poo-poo and pee-pee lyrics. I love dumb stuff. But
there's a test. There's a test for songs.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. So a song is good if I can make up a silly version of it. So
by silly, he means disgusting.
So, like, prime example. The toilet's smelling crappy. I don't want to get sappy, but when you ate those tacos, it made me burst into tears. You know, whatever. Stuff like that. And it's not my best one, but
that is absolutely a test of, okay, this song's good because it's in his head and he yep. wrote something gross about it. So that's probably something we can work
yeah.
with.
Yeah. If I do like a write, like on the next day, I'm usually being like, you know, if I have a melody, na 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 na, and the lyrics super pretty, I'll be like, put my dringus in ya, dringus, boop, beep, 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 yeah.
No,
like, yeah.
This is what happens.
But back, but telling a story and spending time, don't just like, there's, it's not just like I open my heart and my mind and pour forth lyrics on a scroll. It's like, there is a build, it's building. You're building a story, you're building characters. You want to create parallelism and references that callbacks and internal rhyme and all that shit.
And I think that's why country is so huge, because people get attached to the lyrics.
They tell a story.
And country and NASCAR, I've never seen any more diehard fans. Though, I mean, a country, you know, Garth Brooks from, you know, he's been, how long has he been around?
30 years.
Yeah, well, 30 years. He could sell it any stadium he wants right now. 30 years later, in 2022, with inflation to the moon, because he has lyrics. He was professional. People got hooked to the lyrics, and they never left.
Yep.
And that's how country fans are, and in my belief, that's why. Yeah. One of the reasons why.
I always say, like, and again, not because you were in here, but me and Tommy had talked about it. That Happy song, I mean, again, amazing. The lyrics, everything about it. You want a song sometimes, hey, guess what? Everybody has a bad day, and you're like, man, I just want to listen to something that's going to make me cry today. I just want to listen to something that's going to... You know, and then there's the day, you know, I'm having a great day. I need something to get me real energized.
Yeah.
It's all about, I feel, at least me personally, how's my day going? Is it a good day? I'm listening to good music. I'm uppity. Is my day shitty today? Yeah, I'm going to go a little down here, maybe down in the dumps.
And it usually lifts you up.
Correct.
Absolutely.
Now, see, me, like 1,000 years, it sounds sad.
Yeah.
But for me, I would listen to it when I work out.
Yeah.
Yep.
Like, that's a workout song for me.
Yeah.
Because I like it, because of the lyrics, it pumps me up.
Yep.
You know, I can relate to it. So for me, I would work out to that.
Yep. Yeah.
I would also listen to it on a long drive, you know, with the seat back.
Yep.
Yep.
Yeah.
Same thing as well.
And the story, well, there's that story. It sounds macabre, but it's, I mean, honestly, it's a dude saying, I've died every day waiting for you. Kind of dark, but darling,
who can't relate
afraid.
To that?
Yeah. I have loved you for 1,000 years. I mean, that's, you know, sing that to your significant other, and you should be getting some form of.
The first time I actually really listened and heard that song was at my engagement party, because my sister and you and Jesse performed it. My engagement party.
I'd forgotten that I'd played it.
Yeah, I think my lovely wife requested that.
Yes, she did.
Like, so I think I watched the movies, but it was like fine. I didn't really pay much attention to what was going on with any of it. But like when I heard them sing that song, I was like, wow, that's a really really good song.
Yeah, and to go back to like what you're talking about with like Happy and the way lyrics work and things like that. I mean, so when we sat down. There's a bunch of ways of writing lyrics, and it's kind of fascinating where, like, for me, I generally I ask myself a question, like, what would be the saddest thing? Or, like, if I'm a scumbag and I'm singing a song about, like, how much I love somebody, but the premise is that I'm a cheating devil, like, I get into a character to make the lyrics and I start telling a story. Whereas Nick gets inspired by things. So Happy, when we sat down initially, he told me the story. He's like, this is about, like, a guy who's looking at a bride, you know, and you realize in the song that he's sitting in the aisle or he's the best man.
Yeah, he was the best
man.
The
he's in love with her.
You see
her
walking down the aisle.
Yeah.
And you think he's about to marry her, but then you get hit by the idea that no.
Yeah.
This is the best man who is hopelessly in love with.
That makes total sense.
So that was the story. I wouldn't come up with that story because it sounds romantic. And I was like, no. Like,
but you become the character.
Exactly.
Just like, that's, in my opinion, like, I remember Johnny Depp when he was doing Donnie Brasco.
Yep.
He followed the real Donnie Brasco around.
Yep.
For like 6 months. Everywhere he went, everything, how he held his coffee cup.
He did the same thing with Hunter S. Thompson,
Same exact thing. So then he made himself that person.
Yeah.
Just like with the lyrics of the song when you did the song.
Yep.
You know, your brother helped you get into that person.
Oh, yeah.
And then you just belt it out of fucking other monsters.
Nick's a premise guy. Like, he has a premise. Sometimes I'll just get a really cool phrase or a really cool melody, and I'll just throw shit against the wall.
Generally speaking, melody comes first for you. And he, like, I'll bring an idea like that to the table, but for him, he is melodically based a lot of times, and he'll just start playing and singing random syllables.
Oh yeah, it's
and then we pull them together.
It's easy.
And it's like, and then, and once he comes up with a word, then we'll come up with like the rest of the first line.
Yeah, it's like if you get a good like. And suddenly I'm centralized on the sound of window, and that might stay, or yeah. I'll think of something else, but suddenly now I've got...
You got the melody.
And now window is making me think, why am I looking at the window? Okay, am I looking
out? Is this
out
a car window? In? Are we looking out an apartment window?
In this song, it's actually me watching two people have sex, and they don't know I'm there, but I can see it. I see all of it. I see all of it. And that's why the chorus goes...
No. Wait, look, Nick's holding his fucking breath right now.
I was just gonna wait to see how far he's gonna take
I'm
that.
But
it's fun because I think a prime example, Every Breath You Take by The Police.
Yeah.
Everyone used that at their wedding.
Everybody. Yeah.
And
guess what that song's about?
Well, Sting was inspired by Big Brother, of course, to write the song.
Yeah,
but everyone felt it. That like everyone felt that as a romantic song, and it doesn't change the fact that that's what it is for people. But for Sting, he's sitting back and laughing
his ass off.
That's like
collected his check.
Yeah.
Do you remember the song? Is it Brad Paisley and Alison Krauss, "Whiskey Lullaby"?
Whiskey Lullaby, yes.
Put my bottle to the head and pulled my. It's a depressing song. It's
Absolutely.
About a guy who comes back from war, finds out his love of his life, who he's gonna marry, they're meant to be married, is fucking somebody else. He walks in on them. Now he's went off the deep end. He's drinking. He kills himself.
Yep.
Then she is depressed now that he killed himself, and she basically, I think, kills herself too.
Yep.
Nice.
But it's like
a
great
short story.
But you're like, man, it's like
awesome.
Great. But to me, I take it as like a love song. Like, oh, this is a great song. I'm like, wow, actually, they're killing themselves.
Romeo and Juliet. That's proven to be like the love story for a lot of people, and it's tragic, but. It's still a love song, just because it doesn't end like you want. There's a lot of songs like that. I think there's one called Happy.
I think there's one called Good Times, too, right? Good Things.
Yeah.
Close.
Now I'm going to write a song called Good Times, but that's going to be a really upbeat, funky song.
That would be a fun one.
And you will get some points
there.
You got it in the title.
Yeah, Good Times.
Thank you.
But I take music as, for me at least, I'm more of a visual, video guy. That's why I am a video guy. So, we used to do these Children's Miracle Network, it was called, to raise money for kids that had all different sicknesses. And the one song that was overused, but it fit so well, people would tears would be rolling down, was My Wish by Rascal.
Absolutely.
People are crying, right?
Yep.
And then on the other spectrum, when you see a football highlight video or something, there's music that goes to that.
Yeah.
So I always take music and visually I'm like, what would this go with?
Or like Rocky.
Yeah.
That never went away.
Yeah.
That never goes away.
Never.
There's something magical. I'm getting back into 70s and 80s movies. And
we've been doing a lot of 70s, 80s, 90s.
Yeah.
A lot of that.
Specifically, and I haven't shared this with you because you're not, I like Death Race 3000 with, David Carradine. Like really pulpy cult classic things, but the songs they chose, like Buckaroo Banzai, you'd write a theme song for the movie. Mm-hmm. Eye of the Tiger, what's the band who did Eye of the Tiger?
Survivor.
Yes,
Survivor. I believe the story is Sylvester Stallone called them, he liked their band, he called them forever, guy thought it was a joke. So finally he gets a hold of them, it's a whole thing, I don't remember all of it so I don't want to fuck it up, but they say, hey, I love your stuff, I want to use a song. So they spent all this time in the studio writing a song, and then Sylvester Stallone calls him the night before. He's like, awesome, so you're going to send me two, right? He wanted two songs to choose from. They had stayed up all night and cranked out Eye of the Tiger. That was the one they chose, the one they spent all the time in the world on, I think a week or two, I'm not sure, and then Eye of the Tiger, they fart out at night desperately trying, because why are you going to say, you can't give him one song, he asked for two. And there's a prime example of things that happen quick. The song we're going to play for you later on called Dear God, a buddy of mine showed me a particular artist called Father John Misty, and I had this idea about writing a letter to God, and I took those two things together, and the most of those lyrics came out in 20 minutes.
Wow.
Like I had a general thing, and it's like the rest of it was cake. You know, then there's two versions of it. I had an Americana version, and the one that will be on the record will be out.
The Americana version's out right now, actually.
Yeah, you can check out a version of Dear God, which is the super soulful. It's got more like acoustic vibes. It's awesome. And then I took that and did a more a heavy electronic-y vibe for the next record. But that's a prime example of one thing, a guy who I liked his stuff, mm-hmm. and then a concept, and the whole fucking story is right there for you. And that's one where it's like, oh, I can just be me in this. I don't even have to find the guy. I can be mischief.
This is an unedited Kalen song.
Yes.
It's almost like you're segueing.
I don't do a lot of personal.
Play it? Is that what's happening now?
What?
Should we play it?
Yeah. You guys want to hear it?
Yeah.
Sure.
Let's do it.
It seemed like that's what you were doing.
Well, I was setting it up so I wouldn't forget because I forget things.
What's this called? Dear God?
It's called Dear God.
Dear God. And how many singles you have off the album now?
So for my record, we have Good Things, Happy, and
Let Them Come.
Let Them Come. Let Them Come was first.
We also have the cover of Sex and Candy.
Cover of Sex and Candy by Marcy Playground.
Playground. Yeah.
And what we're playing is on a Hi-Fi Americana, which is something my brother Nick and I and our piano player and amazing artist Paul Bellantoni and Michelle Fitzgerald.
Right.
We have an Americana group, and we all bring our songs, and so it's on there. So
yeah,
we had the editor for Sex and Candy in there.
Really?
Remember Christopher, the author?
Oh,
Christopher,
yeah.
I forget his last name. Sorry, Chris. He brought me a bunch of magazines.
Yeah, this record, the Hi-Fi record, we went out to Nashville 2019, and we spent 5 days in the studio, and we did an entire
10 songs.
Yeah, we did it. We had an idea to like do all come out at the same time and record, and then we started in.
Yep.
And it turned into a whole album.
We were gonna push it really hard too, and then some. I can't remember what happened. Something called Corona.
Yeah. No. Our the release. The album came out March 9th, 2020.
Yeah.
It was
good
to
timing.
The point where we. Oh. I mean, we were. It was the last day of
before everything shut
down. Yeah. Just real quick before you guys start. So. When you do this now with the way things are,
yeah,
do you think obviously it's better to go single with the way things are versus before you would release one or two singles and then you would come out with the album?
It depends. For me right now, so we're doing the cover. What we want to do is if I get enough push and enough clout and there's enough
traction.
Some tour dates, if I have enough places to play. Having a hard copy vinyl or CD and putting out a record is awesome. Even if it doesn't blow the fuck up right away, I'm going to be supporting it on the road. But since I'm not touring a lot, putting out songs and focusing on online stuff is the way to do it. So the answer is both are great ways, both are viable, but don't like
when you track sales and albums. An album is old now, very fast.
Yeah,
people are over it. They've downloaded it. They've listened to it. Most of the time, they're done with it in a few weeks. So when you have song, you're keeping your name going.
Yeah,
you can do
keep
song,
relevant,
and that's what you're saying.
Music video, acoustic, because we have an acoustic version of Good Things that we did, and that's out as well. That we did one take.
Yep.
So you go until you get enough traction, and then you go on tour.
And then you can put out like random, like and that's why you have extra songs. Put out a couple bonus things. You got to keep putting
re-release the bonus version.
Yeah.
Also, it's like you just find different ways. It's all about having something to talk about.
I want
to
do.
You get on the social media every day, and you have to say, this is what's going on in my life right now. This is what's coming out next. This is what's out right
and
now.
And then on tour, it's most likely that they'll buy the album or a lot of people there will. So that makes
the dream
sense.
Is that you
answered that perfectly.
Like, I really want to do a version of like my record where I play everything. So this is like, good things are happening somewhere. But if I just move my hand up and play the exact same
don't
chords.
Do it.
Good things are happening somewhere.
I like it the other way.
No, this is so much better.
Hey, hey.
Nobody lets me burn my career down. Right, the song is called Dear God, and I think you'll get the gist of it.
And once again, thank you guys very much for doing this for us.
This is always a pleasure, buddy. Thanks for having us. Dear God, make me a bird so I can fly from the world. Fly from the world. And dear God, forgive my sin so I can sin once again. Sin once again. If they can win, why can't I? Are we not equal in your eyes? If there's a grading curve in this life, I'd rather die.
I don't blame you for the free will that you gave. Sure as I don't blame you for the mess we've made. Don't claim to have the brains to understand. Won't question your devotion or your plans. Won't curse your name for our mistakes or slap the blessings from your hands. I hope you know I love you, Lord. I just hate all your fans. I just hate all your fans. And dear God, make me a bird so I can shit on the world. Shit on the world. And dear God, forgive my sins so I can fuck up again. I'm gonna fuck up again. Oh, dear God, make me a king so I can fix everything.
Come on,
fix everything. From the neck till they're dead, slam the greedy crooks down on their privileged heads, and the people sing their praises for their pretty new monster. Yeah, we lost the plot. I don't blame you for the free will that you gave. Sure as I don't blame you for the mess we've made. Don't claim to have the brains to understand. Question your devotion or your plans. Don't curse your name for our mistakes or slap the blessings from your hands. I hope you know I love you, Lord. I just hate all your fans. I just hate all your fans. There's a grading curve in this life. I'd rather die. I'd rather die. I don't blame you for the free will that you gave. Sure as I don't blame you for the mess we've made. Don't claim to have the brains to understand. Don't question your devotion or your plans. Don't curse your name for our mistakes or slap the blessings from your hands. I hope you know I love you, Lord. I just hate all your fans.
That was good. I like it.
That was awesome. Like that with one. The only Kalen Chase and his brother's twist on that.
Yeah.
Only way you could possibly pull that off.
It's you have to have a bit of a smile when you say it, because there's not one. I'm going to play it at a Nashville Writers Round, and because I want to see how many people just tune right out and not realize that. Wait, there's nothing anti-God.
I was just going to say that too, because I bet you, if you don't listen to the words, you don't realize that you say, "I love you, God."
Yeah,
I just hate. And you're just saying you hate the fans, and you know if I do something wrong, A B, but. In the end, you say, I love you, God.
Yeah.
In the beginning, you think you're saying, fuck God.
Yeah, exactly.
But if you listen to the lyrics, which I don't know if this day and age can.
If they don't, then the best thing is it's a litmus test. So people who are like you and anybody who just gives something a chance and waits before passing judgment, then my stuff is for you. If you're the kind of twat burglar who just fucking, no, that makes me, no, no, there's something bad like about it. God, don't do that.
Listen to the fucking lyrics.
Yeah, and also, please relax. Just relax.
Relax.
Yeah, I like that. I take that as like the, and this is why I took it, is the people that go to church every Sunday, they walk in, they do the cross, I'm so sorry, and then they walk out and they're this person that,
oh, yeah,
this person that.
Yeah.
It's basically, fuck you.
Yeah. The reason Jesus hung out with tax collectors and prostitutes and so-called sinners was because there were no hypocrisy in them. And what did he do in the temple? He fucked that shit up.
Yep.
And not just, there's plenty of practicing
deeply
religious.
The vast majority of people that go and are and say that they are a Christian are good people.
Yep.
and they live the best they can. We're all human, so we make, yeah, mistakes.
It's the hypocrisy and the small amounts that are the, yeah, loudest ones, because if you, yeah, know that you're full of shit, you're going to be like, no, 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 look how good I am. Don't look at that pile of ugliness. No, look at how good I am. And then you get burned by that and you realize, and then it's easy, and I've done it before, where it's like, oh, yeah, these people suck, so the whole thing, and which is exactly what we're trying to stand against. So I want to start, I want this song to make people talk, ask, yeah, questions, talk to each other, fight about it a little bit, have some fun. Don't, you know, go crazy.
That's
but
the idea.
Yeah, I was going to say, this will be controversial,
yeah,
which is good.
Oh, yeah.
Which is good for
and
numbers.
How did you, yeah, come up with this again? How did you?
So there is a my friend John Fitzgerald. John,
yeah, it's Michelle's. So yep. Michelle and I sing in a duo called Fitzmo, and that was part of the Hi-Fi Americana thing, and John is a purveyor of all things good.
Yeah, he's got great taste.
Things.
We love him.
Yeah.
And he came up to me. He's like, I don't know how you haven't heard this guy. He's Father John Misty. And so I watched some of his things, and there was something kind of like old school piano-based, like theatrical, deep songs, incredible lyrics, somewhat subversive, and just so well done. I was like, oh, and that, and I was like, I need to do my homage and my version of what a Father John Misty thing is. And the premise was already there because I wanted to do a letter to the big guy. And I was like, this is it. I get to rip the shit out of douchebags, sing about God, piss people off, inspire that's a good conversation, and write a good melody. I was like, that's a boner bag right
and
there.
And then end it with, I love God.
Yeah.
But not the fans.
Yeah. I just hate all your fans. I can't sing it without having a shit eating grin. That's the best.
It's true. I mean, I think there's a John Fugel saying, who's a great comedian and
yes,
radio host in and of himself. He said it's something to the effect of, I feel the same way about Jesus as I do about Elvis. Love the guy, not a fan of the, like, don't hate the fan club.
Yeah, so, like, hate the fan club.
Like, not a fan of the fans. Like, that was that, like, so when he did that, I was like, dude, because we loved that when we heard it from John. That had to be 15 years ago we heard that, maybe.
You told me that much later. I didn't realize that was him. But he's another, like, I like subversive, challenging things, and that can be on any side.
Yep.
It doesn't matter what it is. Like, first off, get my attention.
Yep.
And it's a great lesson for me to be like, okay, do not immediately start passing judgment because of my biases.
Right.
And then it's like, okay, this could be. And then when it's somebody fun and something fun, like a movie or a song or an idea, it's like, this is a perfect conversation. Let's go have a drink, and let's see where we both stand, and we can laugh about it. And if you're willing to make fun of yourself, and nothing is sacred to me. My mom disagrees with me because, like, I don't believe that if there is whatever capacity you believe in God, and if you don't know worries, but if there is some form of spiritual oneness over us, that spiritual oneness does not have self-esteem issues or an identity crisis. So call that what you want. It doesn't fucking matter.
You want to hear a really fucking interesting story?
Yes.
There was this really, really intelligent, he spent 14 years researching this, and he was trying to find the basis of mushrooms, like psychedelics, back. And again, I just have an open mind, so I listen to everything and take it for what it's worth. And he did 14 years of research, so much that he went into a cave and found scriptures that were written on cow skin. So to date it, they had to get the DNA from the cow skin to date when it came from.
That's awesome.
And when it had come from was back when, you know, caves and everything, and mushrooms were everywhere.
Yeah.
And what he had thought after 14 years of investigation is that the Bible was misinterpreted. Religion was misinterpreted. So they would pray to a mushroom for it to rain.
Yeah.
Because whenever it rained, all of a sudden they wake up and boom, a ton of mushrooms will pop up.
Yeah.
Then they eat it, trip off the balls. They can go kill fucking animals. They don't have any fear, so on and so forth.
Yeah.
Then there was another mushroom that they would pray to, and it looked just like Santa Claus. They actually called it the Santa Claus mushroom.
Oh man.
Yeah, we can Google it later, the name of it. And he had found this out all in these scriptures. Now, when it comes to like religion and the Bible, the issue I kind of have with that is that's people interpreting it in their own way. And people, when they interpret something, they're going to interpret it in the best way that benefits them.
Yes.
Right? To get the most power, to get the most whatever it may be.
Yeah.
So when you have other people writing what they had, the way they saw it, they're going to write it in a way that's beneficial toward them, in my opinion.
Yeah.
I just thought that was an interesting thing.
This is my jam. I used to study theology, like we talked about that. And the all, like, there's so much. When you step away from the concept that that book that has been rewritten with books taken out of it and the Council of Nicaea and everybody else who, and a bunch of rich white dudes gave us their edited version of the Bible. If we can suddenly step back and say, this is here is not the inspired word of God. There are God's words in there, and there are things that are, you know, whatever. There's beautiful things in there. But it's not, God didn't write that, people. Their Council of Nicaea chose which books to give you. There's a bunch of, like you've seen the lost books of the Bible. So if you do that and you take the lessons from it, suddenly it's like, oh, wow, this doesn't, my spiritual world isn't crumbling with this realization. Doesn't mean that it's not important. Doesn't mean you can do the exact same things. But don't tell me that God was responsible for all of the edits of the book that the dudes did. Tell me that.
What I found interesting, sorry, Rob, about this guy's, you know, end hypothesis was that back then, all they cared about was fertility. Because remember, people are dying off left and right.
Absolutely.
You know, you get anything, there's no medicine.
Yeah.
You're done for. So all they were about was fertility and psychedelics. Because psychedelics gave, really, this isn't a joke, gave them the balls to go up to a tiger or whatever it may be. They smell pheromones. They know that you have no fear. They don't know what you are. They just know you don't have any fear.
Yeah.
And then you have the balls as a human to go kill something that would eat you in 2 seconds.
Yep.
But it doesn't know who you are. It knows your smell.
Yeah.
And it can tell that you're not afraid because you're tripping balls.
Yep.
It makes total sense to me.
Yeah.
I want that to be true just because it's awesome.
Do you think, though, that, and this is a question I have. Okay, like we talk about Adam and Eve, right?
Mm-hmm.
Do I believe that this person ate an apple? No. But do you think, like, okay, think of the Jewish religion, Moses, right? The burning bush, all that type of stuff, right? Moses was an actual real person that existed. Jesus was a real person that existed.
Yeah.
You believe that they were historically people that, like Tommy, your name's Tommy, you existed, and maybe you told people you saw a burning bush and God came to you.
Yeah.
Do you think that person actually existed, or you think that was just completely made up?
I think he was tripping balls and may have seen that.
No, but the person themselves, like, Moses may have been tripping, and the bush really wasn't on fire, but he is an actual person that exists. His name was Moses. Do you think that person existed?
Probably not. You know, many times as it was rewritten and hands got on it, probably not.
Okay.
There's so sometimes they'll use one person. Another thing to realize, like, that the Israelites of the day, the writing style was all very image based. So, you know, you write something like, look at a fig tree. A fig tree represents a nation to them.
Well, Kalen, remember I told you it took 14 years?
Yeah.
And Nick?
Yeah.
Well, 4 of the years was trying to transcribe the images.
Yeah. Oh, I can't even
just
imagine.
As you said.
Yeah. Exactly.
So he took 4 years, experts out the ass. And the way he had the money was he had like a Fortune 500 company. And for whatever reason, he got obsessed with this.
Nice.
And he sold the company and he just went on this journey to figure this shit out.
A mushroom and pilgrimage.
And again, I have an open mind to anything because I don't want to be fucking wrong, and you know what I mean? So my mind's open.
Yeah.
But he felt that Jesus was a mushroom, that they prayed to Jesus because whenever it rained, mushrooms would come up. So they prayed to the mushroom, rain again, and they would get rain, which would bring water.
Gotcha. Right?
So on and so forth.
I think God...
kind of makes a little bit of sense.
Well, I definitely believe that, like, how especially the Santa Claus mushroom gives us that patriarchal kind of, like, God thing. But when you get into later dates, like, when... And suddenly you have a story, and you also have, like, the Babylonian records, and you start getting, like, bank things, and you start seeing there's certain people that are definitely real.
People, yeah.
Jesus was most likely, pretty sure, was real because of the things based on, like, so you know, you had
that
the
was
Romans,
the census,
you had,
right? They had
there's
the census.
Census. Yeah. And now you have to look at all this 2,000-year-old shit, and you know, they could be twisted. But I think some of these people were real. The concept of God makes perfect sense that it started there. I mean, that's where, I mean, people thinking of those, some of those constellations don't look like fucking the thing they said they are, but if you're tripping balls, I get it.
Well, yeah. Remember back then, DMT was active in your brain.
Yeah.
So it was actively pumping. And yeah. Then you mix some shrooms with that, good night, homie. You're in another fucking dimension, yeah. And do not give a shit.
See, I think like if you go to the Old Testament and the New Testament, and Jewish people will be mad at me for this, but the Old Testament, right? I think a lot of that stuff is just made up. I think when you get to the New Testament, again, what you believe, but the New Testament, again, you may not believe that Jesus is a part of God and all this raising up to heaven, all that type of stuff, but I think the person himself was a real person.
Yeah,
I tend to believe that.
I think he did stuff, and maybe they were on mushrooms, and he did something, and they're like, oh, he healed me, and that's where the healer part comes in. And then when you talk about Mary, and they say, well, she was a virgin, and she had child. I mean, come on, that I say no to, too, but...
Yeah, you know, I'm with you. I think definitely, and you... And I believe you too, Nick. I think there was definitely a Jesus, but this is happening in different parts of the world.
Yeah.
Where they had all the banger mushrooms, I really do think that they thought Jesus was that mushroom.
Well, multiple religions have a similar, so it's like as we get closer and closer to present day, you know, and civilizations kept records, like I think it plays into what you're saying a lot.
It's a mixture of that.
I think the powerful thing is faith is a powerful weapon that can be used for good if you are intentional in how you go about it. I don't want to know for sure. You know, I think people run into the problem of they get obsessed with wanting to know the unknowable. They want to know what happens after they die. They're scared of death, and so they
yearn for an answer.
Yeah. What we know for sure is we're here.
Yeah.
Like I take that as like I know for sure that I'm here right now and that I'm supposed to be a good person. And I think in order to bring out the best in our humanity at this point, we need a couple of things. I think that humans need other humans. I think that other humans make us better. We are to the point where our mental evolution is the most important thing, right? Our brains are what is evolving at the highest level now because we don't need to hunter, gather, procreate anymore, but we can sure as hell get smarter. And so I think other people help make us smarter. And I think realizing and surrendering to the fact that I don't know everything, but that I am open to possibilities, I think that helps make us better too. So those are things I think help get us.
It's been an underlying theme of the whole
thing. I want you guys to see this mushroom. Rob, look up Anamita Mascaria mushroom. It looks like fucking Santa Claus. I'm just Anamita Mascaria mushroom.
The internet's amazing.
Yeah, everything's on the internet. M A S C A R I A mushroom. I'm sure that spelling's not right.
Anamita mascara. I mean, maybe Google will find it.
Yeah.
There we go.
Yep.
That.
All right. Go to images.
Oh, animate mass.
Is that right there?
Is that what that is? Yeah. There's other ones that look more like a Santa Claus.
We've got the red and white.
Yeah, you got the red and white. There's better pictures, but you get the idea.
Yeah. And I mean, that's so funny. I mean, you got your Nordic religions,
they called it Santa Claus.
Yeah.
Like snow on top of it and shit.
Yeah.
I mean, there is better ones, but
they look fake almost, but they're real. That's crazy.
Put a Santa Claus next to mushroom, because there's one that it's white and it actually, I mean, really resembles like the beard. You see it?
Yeah.
You know, I love crazy, that. Right?
Look at the mushrooms coming into the camera.
Yeah. Yeah. The shaman. Because, you know, like the shaman, back then they used to come down and everything. Look at that. Now tell me how you cannot see like the correlation.
I totally get it.
Yeah.
I want that to be just unequivocally
fucking interesting.
I want
it
to be true so bad because that's such a great story.
Well, it is true.
I mean, just the, I desperately want this to be like Santa Claus is actually a mushroom.
Oh.
I want it to go farther. This is my problem. I start getting carried away.
You know what's interesting, though?
Mm.
That guy wrote a book on all of this.
Nice. I want to read this.
They banned it, and then guess who bought it?
Who?
the Catholic Church.
That's what happens.
So then he came back out and rewrote one, and it's called the squirrel and the mushrooms. That's what it's actually called. So it's nice. Rewritten a little bit differently, but the Catholic Church actually bought the book. So they banned it, and then so that if he wanted to start selling it on his own,
yeah.
They went and, you know, made him basically an offer that
he couldn't refuse.
Yeah. You know? Well, they probably have the power to blow his brains out too. So you can have this money.
A, yeah.
And you can not do the book, or you can not do the book because you're dead and don't get money.
Yeah. A or B.
Yeah.
So now when you're, now that you're, you know, doing Kalen Chase, what is the biggest difference between, not the music wise, but being in a band like Korn, Vimic, and now doing it this way? What is the biggest difference between the two, would you say? And Nick as well. So, I know you were around. Not like you were like in a cave somewhere.
No,
or if you were,
much,
I'd like
never,
to know about the mushrooms.
Much, no, never been much of a cave dweller. I've always kind of, you know.
He's always been, you know, he's witnessed it. So Korn is one thing because I was a hired gun. So my job was very simple. I learned the songs. I did a good live show. I didn't fuck up. I showed up on time. I, you know, knew my place. It was super fun. There was no like, you know, don't look at the talent. Like we were buddies. Then Vimic, when I became the lead singer and the lyricist, and Joey and Chris Norris were the songwriters, and they gave me the songs, and I wrote the lyrics.
That was Scar the Martyr, is what you joined
originally. His band,
right?
Scar the Martyr, and yeah. So their singer left. They fired him or whatever. I joined. We changed the band name to Vimic. Now I'm making the soup. So I'm. This is like a collective where Joey is the most popular guy. He's a freaking legend. I'm doing the lyrics. And so that was an interesting power dynamic. And things started getting interesting when we left Roadrunner and a new deal was signed. And unfortunately, I was not put on that deal. So I still had my, they didn't like steal my master or my pro, right. But I suddenly now had no connection really or affiliation to the label. They were very nice. I talked to them, you know, but we never really got a chance for me to get the clout to become an egomaniac and fight for those things, which I'm glad. And I don't think I would have. But so at that point, like when you're in a band, like something like that, and especially when you're in a band with an established person, the fans care about him. And you can earn their love and you can get it, but you're also going to have haters. So that's a then there's not a lot of people who've been in that situation. I mean, there's plenty, there's enough, but like that's not the norm. So when, but I had a voice. I was responsible for the lyrics and the melodies, and it was cool. I was the front man. So as opposed to being a background guy, you know, having to play good. Now if the band sucks, what's the first thing they're going to do? I'm the thing they're going to remember because I'm the mouthpiece. So if somebody shits the bed or the show's not great, they're like, that sucks. And I'm going to get the, which is fine. You sign up for that because you also get the glory. You get all that stuff together. You get different things and egos and not egos and how to be, you know, and it's a metal thing too. And metal is a very specific situation. So you get all that going. This is my thing. So I'm in charge. I have smart people with me, but they're, you know, it's going to be my vision. Nick says that I'm the engine. And so I'm pushing it forward and I've got great components and I have regulators that say, hey, engine, you're about to drive off the fucking cliff. So, and Nick says, like, you know, I'm working for you in this capacity. And that's a hard thing. He's my older brother. You know, it's like, we're partners. He's like, no.
My name's not on it.
And so
the thing's called Kalen
and
Chase.
So then I have
to
be
interesting to settle into that.
I got to get comfortable with that, which is fine. But like, you know, he's an integral part of the songwriting process. His opinion is valid. But no, I have to take full responsibility, which after Vimic is scary because now there's nothing but like me.
It's like empty, right?
Yeah. So
like you're kind of alone.
Alone
for the first
in the
time
sense
in
that,
a way.
Yeah. Yeah. If it goes great, awesome. And I will be shoving everybody who helped me do it. But if it goes shitty, I can't be like, oh, well, if the people I worked with, no, it's me.
Well, the rule of management for me is this. If, as a manager of anything, when you're doing well, your team's doing a great job and everything's great. And when you're not, it's your fault.
How many years are you managing? Like, I mean, he did music business, but he also managed like big restaurants and things like that. He's always been dealing with psychos and egos.
When you have, you know, basically management means you are accountable to someone for your performance, and you are accountable for other people's performance. And
all
so,
the logistics, yeah. Right? And then it all falls on you.
Yep. At the end of the day, it's like if things are going well, my team is doing great. And if they're not, it's my fault. Like, what? It's my fault. And that's how you have to deal with these situations. And that's what he's being faced with, because he's the only, like, it's his, like I said, it's his name.
It's another reason, like, he managed back in the day when I was doing metal stuff, like, he was my manager. And it.
Well, it, I mean, I was your band's manager.
Bands, like, my
and
band.
I was, you know, that definitely worked.
He got us some good gigs and things, but then, like, having that situation, because he feels the same. I took responsibility for my band, so like when it was bad, it was me. But he was doing the same thing as the manager, and so we'd both be like kicking our own asses, and then we'd come together and we'd basically fight about whose ass. Like, we were just, it didn't work in that sense.
I mean, by the time I got involved, your band was. I mean, the thing that came out of managing you, quote unquote, was your Korn gig.
Yeah, he was the one who talked me into doing that.
And Kalen, you also, to go on your own now, you worked with some of the best. So you were able to, you know, learn from them, and now that you're on your own like this, you had those years of experience to say, okay, you know, I learned quite a bit.
It's awesome. Like, the big thing is how to communicate, which ties into a lot of things you were saying, like not preconceived notions, not letting my ego speak first. Still working on it, but like to have, especially when talking with Crystal, from Mind Our Music, my manager. Like, if there's an idea, for me not to immediately shut it down, like.
Well, you know, it's both. It's like he has a need to say yes or no right away. Like, he basically, like, his general consensus is just, if something comes up, yes, I'll do it.
Or no right away without thinking about it.
Like, he figures it out later.
I have very patient people.
We don't think things through.
I don't like long conversations, like about stuff like that. It's like, what do you want? Yes, I'll do it. Fine.
Same way.
I do that with friends, with family, with my business.
Because you just don't want to hear it. You're not being a dick. You just don't want to hear it.
There's no malice in it.
I just want to get it done so we can move on to the next thing. Now I'm learning and in the process of... first off, asking questions, weighing the pros and cons, hearing their opinions, seeing what they're... And biggest thing, the easiest thing is like, well, what do you think? Like, if you bring something to me, whether it's Nick or Crystal or my wife's idea or something, whatever it is, and whether it's music or anything, just like, well, what do you think? Does it sound like a good idea to you? Right, tell me some details. It sounds like a lot of fucking talking, but it's, but it'll pay off in the end, because I won't be in a situation that I'm A, not prepared for, or B, don't want to do. Because then you have to grin and bear it, and doing something you don't like that you're obligated to do sucks. That's why I stopped working real jobs. Like, I work for myself because I don't want to do shit I don't want to do.
Understandable. Yeah. Completely understandable.
Yeah.
Now, remember I was telling you I found a little clip on MTV Unplugged. Do you remember that?
I remember doing that.
Tab 7. Remember, I asked you how that line, I cut it up. That's you right there with the shit on your head, right?
Oh, yeah, the bunny ears.
Hey, look, it's the bunny.
I wore that thing for probably 6 months at the most, maybe 7.
It stayed with you,
though. And they still call me the albino ribbit in Australia, and the Jaeger Hassen. Yeah, something like Jaeger soup or Jaeger. I can't remember. They call me a German rabbit thing in Europe.
It happens to have Jaeger in it.
And I played for a couple of years without.
But it stuck with you.
It stuck with, and I don't mind it. It's fun.
How important to the band was this MTV Unplugged?
I think it was huge for them.
Huge, because I remember Unplugged was like...
Oh, yeah.
That was when MTV actually was music.
It was phasing out, but it was...
Well, this was actually like... Because it came and went. It, like, so huge in the 90s. Everyone did MTV Unplugged. Amazing. And then it kind of went away for a while. And then it came back. This was like the second incarnation of it. And I mean, for me, who's not into metal, I thoroughly... enjoyed this whole show. It was really cool to watch these songs get interpreted. Plus, you know, you had, I mean,
we had The Cure.
The Cure was there.
Like, we had all kinds of great guests.
It was just a stacked show. Yeah. It was very cool.
And they worked so hard with the music director, like to play these heavy songs. And they got the 7-string acoustics. They had these cellos or bass, like uprights, that were tuned even lower. So they got all the low end sound.
Didn't you learn an instrument?
I learned the mandolin, and they'd cut the song with the mandolin after I spent a week learning it. So I didn't play the mandolin for like 10
years.
But it
has come in handy.
Yes, I'm back on it. I'm learning it. But I played like a marxophone, which is this hammering thing. I played the bells.
I saw you play the bells.
Yeah, and that was, so John played two because they're just one pitch each. So it's like, bing, 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 bing. And having to remember where to do it was.
Like, John, that build up was just monstrous.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and then all of a sudden, let's go.
Yeah, now that shit's
probably this Rob.
Oh, you actually, it's not just a picture.
No.
Holy shit,
I cut it up so it wasn't 5 minutes. Yeah, it was like a 4 minute clip.
Oh,
like right there where they're building up. Watch you. Just little clips of you. Yeah.
That was a blast. I mean, there were so many random instruments. I got stuck on the turnpike because my phone was on silent on accident, and I wasn't used to cell phones, and so the rest
pink
of the back
razor,
band
wasn't
left.
It then?
Yeah, it's my pink razor. I still have it. I'll turn it back on one of these days. So we're going to Times Square where the MTV building is, and I got the most like just New Jersey guy, or I couldn't tell. Like he was so New York and or New Jersey that his accent I couldn't even place it. And he was arguing with the last fare about money. And he gets in there. Don't worry, we're zooming. We're gonna zoom. We're gonna fucking zoom. Don't you worry. Hey, and you're a great guy. You have a place in heaven. I'm gonna see you in heaven one day. And I'm like sitting here. I'm like, I'm gonna be late for MTV fucking Unplugged. And this guy is just. We're in the fucking turnpike.
So and he's telling you he's gonna see you in heaven.
Yeah, it was.
You're like, I don't know what that means right now.
Yeah, I mean, he was super, and he was a really nice guy. But it's like I didn't have the bandwidth to handle. I was just freaking out. I was like, I'm always polite. So I was like, yes, okay, cool, awesome. And normally I'd be like, this is so fun. This is a piece of like New York, New Jersey. Like this is a cabbie from rough and tumble, like something. And I get out and I'm short and it's wall-to-wall people in Times Square. So finally I just call somebody. I was like, somebody come to the center of Times Square, listen to the sound of me screaming. And our camera guy pulled me in. It was fine. I had like an hour and a half. It was good. But like, yeah, it was this was a big, big deal for, I mean, there's a select amount of bands who got to do this.
Yeah,
and
that was huge.
Well, they won a Grammy, huge. Didn't it?
Congratulations.
I think it got nominated.
Yeah, it got nominated, right?
Yeah.
Definitely got nominated. I thought it might have won Best Live Album or something.
Nah, because I would have gotten some kind of plaque.
Were you at Woodstock 99?
No.
Fuck.
No.
Were you at any Woodstocks?
No, I did a Warped tour in 2000, but I was still knee deep in the church. I was only 15, 16 then, and I didn't get to do any of those.
Oh shit, I forgot.
Korn played Woodstock 99.
They were Woodstock 99. For
yeah.
Sure, yeah.
Yeah, because I watched the documentary and I don't, like, what the hell happened? Because it seemed like it was going fine.
I believe it was Limp Bizkit's fault, wasn't it?
No.
There was just
scroll down. They do blame it on Limp Bizkit.
I know,
well,
that's what I'm saying. Like,
their song Inside.
Scroll down. What's that, guys?
One of the big things was Limp Bizkit's set, like they did that song Break Stuff, and that
right.
was where that was the tipping point.
They said, okay, water problem, hot yep. tarmac.
There was some, I mean, yeah, it was like there
people
was
were selling
issues, first of all, and
and they were like charging too much for water.
Remember Insane Clown Posse?
Oh my God, they were
money giveaway, Kid Rock's recycling program, keep going down, Dave Matthews, Hornball. I don't know what the hell he did.
There's an abundance of titties. What?
Oh, well, all right.
All right.
Well, that's, yeah, I don't see what the big deal there is.
Yeah, go a little quicker through some of these.
There
downloads.
It is.
Where?
I thought it said something about
truck randomly. Yeah.
Runaway cops, crowd surfing, no vacancy, the emerging artist stage, overcrowding.
Yeah, I mean it was just a recipe for disaster. John has a segment in it where he's I'm gonna watch it because I.
Why does Creed always get a bad name? Can you guys answer that?
They're a talented musical band, but his voice was so they got overplayed, they got overhyped, and at the end of the day, that voice was. It was at the height of the post-grunge. It was super popular, and then there was this sea change where everybody's conscious. It happened to me because I was listening to him. And me and my buddy just took the CD out, never listened to it again. I was like, no.
Didn't Dad say something to you?
He said it sounded like Pearl Jam was constipated or something. Like, but that
he inspired you. That was part of the deal.
I liked Creed.
I liked them when they came out, but there was something about his voice that was, and knowing
it's like anything else that.
They did overplay it.
We got sick of it.
It has nothing to do with how good or bad a song is when you hear it that much.
And Scott Stapp was kind of a douche nozzle. He was doing, and so then when you have a voice, with arms wide open, relates to her, and it becomes a caricature, and it's too easy to mock. He might have been genuinely singing from the heart like that, but it sounds like he's trying to sing like a grunge guy. And that's unfortunate if it's what it sounds like, whether
it's
true or not.
There's been a ton of guys tried to emulate it. Like you heard other bands. It's when something gets that big, you get a
95 to 2000 was when bands were trying to sound like Alice in Chains or mostly Pearl Jam, like the Stone Temple Pilots. Everybody was trying to get that.
Yeah.
Even Metallica was.
When I think about it, because I was going to the gym all the time, and they were always playing we would call it grunge music up in Philly, right? Yeah. So, and they would always be like that, like, you know, the Creeds, Bush. They play Bush back.
Bush was a direct response. Bush. I love a lot of their songs.
Well, like Bush was reminded me of Nirvana, and
Bush really wanted to be like Nirvana.
Because like I think their big song, the Nirvana, Little Things, is very much very close. Yeah. Listen to Smells Like Teen Spirit.
Did you guys ever meet Nirvana?
No, I played on the same festival with Dave Grohl doing something else a couple times and saw him in passing. Never got to hang out too much with him, but
very talented, right?
Dave Grohl is not only talented, but he's super amazing. And Nirvana, so Nirvana, the Seattle scene, we had like Soundgarden was already kind of going in late 80s, like they were going.
Well, it was the Temple of the Dog.
So there was Mother Love Bone, which was the several members of Pearl Jam, and their singer Andy Wood died of a drug overdose. So they're forlorn, and Chris Cornell's already starting to blow up, but they do Temple of the Dog, and they get Eddie Vedder to come
season
up from California.
Was another one,
Mad
right?
Season. So all these, so these are people who are coming from the late 80s, and they're doing something different. Eddie Vedder's voice is absolute raw. It's why it sounds so unique and so weird. And that's why as fucking Scott Weiland from Stone Temple Pilots, it's coming up around the same time, and you can hear his voice from the first record, which goes like it's very much in that grungy thing, and then you realize what his voice actually sounds like, mm-hmm. and you get it later on, and it's like it's way less. It's like now he gets. He was a flower girl. He has a really cool scream and a really cool singing voice.
One of those later STP albums is like start to finish. Yeah, really beautiful. But that was the first time that you felt like Scott Weiland wasn't trying to be Eddie Vedder.
The big it's an easy thing to do, and I think we could be wrong about it, but how I base stuff is, and I do this with my students, like, what does your voice sound like? What is your vocal center? Technically, it's in this timber of my voice where I speak is my vocal center. So when I sing, I start to hold the pitch right. Here is my basic thing. Now I can add shit to it, add emotion to it, but that's my sound. And when I sing and people are like, wow, it sounds so authentic, or they compliment it, it's because I'm not trying to sing like Dave Matthews.
Right. Mm.
So that's why Scott Stapp has it. I have an issue with how he's doing it.
Totally.
It sounds forced.
Makes total sense.
It was always, I listened to them a lot, and people used to make fun of me later. I'm like, Creed was the shit. And then the other one that always, it's like Creed and Nickelback.
Nickelback gets a lot of shit.
Like, you listen to Nickelback. Like, why that too? What was it with them?
So Nickelback blew up. They were started off as kind of like a post grunge kind of.
They were,
thing.
Weren't they? They were really heavy.
They were
like
pretty damn heavy.
Like, they were trying to be really heavy, and then they had the big first song.
Yeah, and then
You Remind Me.
Yeah.
So that was their big. Like, they did a few heavy ones. This Is How You Remind Me is that hook. I've been wrong. I've been down. Like.
That was perfect mock of it. I mean, that sounds exactly.
He's got a great voice, and he.
You could put a Halloween mask. On. He could be three different fucking people.
I could do my Chad Kroeger, but they blew up so quick, and then they realized the scenario. What they started doing was taking that formula, and doing it. And so, what happens when you get successful? People hate.
Yep.
And it became
kind of how you know you made it.
Well, and this is also a burgeoning. Kind of like you had the internet. So this is like the way social media was working. We were seeing a combination. This was the band to choose. This was the target. So this is the meme. This is what's on the forums or the talk. This is what's popular and trending. You hate Nickelback. So that it spread like wildfire because it was the perfect time and the perfect place. There's no other reason because I find Nickelback to be just fine. There's nothing wrong with them. Some of their songs I like a lot. Some of the songs I don't give a shit.
I mean, the thing about it is they're well-crafted songs. All of them are well-crafted, and yes, they probably sound similar, but it's always interesting. It sticks with you, like Rockstar sticks with you.
Well, they had the hit that was, that's why I never understood the hate. Because they had, you know, How You Remind Me, and then it was... the hero song from Spider-Man.
Yeah.
Right. We're in the fucking Spider-Man soundtrack.
Oh, yeah. And they were it's with the singer of Saliva, I believe.
Yeah.
Yeah. So half of the people who say they hate Nickelback were lying.
Yeah, they listen to them.
They're definitely
they say you hate Nickelback. You play them a piece of a Nickelback song, and they don't even know. And they say, "Yeah, I do like that song." It's like,
yeah.
Like, I think I made a bet. Didn't I make a bet with you one time? I was like, "I'll play you five songs, and you won't be able to deny that you like at least two of them, and I think I won.
Yes, you did.
I played
you
him
did.
Five Nickelback songs just to prove it.
There was, and it's, so I didn't care about Nickelback, but I was like, but Nick was trying to champion like understanding and open mindedness, and I'm glad he did, because I didn't like join in the band. Like I was just like, I don't. My indifference is equal to most people's hate. Just like, I don't give a fuck about you.
Well, that's, indifference is truly the opposite, because love and hate come from the same spot. Mm-hmm. The opposite of love is indifference, and the opposite of hate is indifference. If you don't care truly about something, that's way different.
Yeah,
I live there. If you feel a certain way about it, then you got the capacity to feel another way about it.
But yeah, this for Nickelback has plenty of fans. They're doing fine. It was just, it was the perfect, like, what, that was the beginning of how, a firestorm of an idea can do their thing on the internet. It's like, that was the first time I think that I can remember. Like, it's not just the Lucy, like, I Love Lucy, like, rape thing, the news lady falling off. That's that now suddenly we can do that same thing going viral with hate.
I just never understood where the hate for Creed and Nickelback came from. And it was like, we can understand now, maybe not then, like now people hate R. Kelly. Well, we can understand.
There's a good
Kelly.
Reason. There's
we
a good
get
reason.
It. We yeah. get it.
That's
he's a scumbag.
Book top four.
Yep.
Yeah. But that's, there's a different thing. Like, it's like your personal decorum, you know.
And Kalen. When's the new single come out?
September
23rd. There you go. All right. Make sure we get that. Gotta get that.
I fucking did it.
Great
guys.
Song.
I'm the
great
smartest song. Man alive. So this is always such a good time, guys. You guys are a fun hang.
Really. Been great hanging, guys.
So I still want to know more about this 360 deal. So when I pull this up and I read it and I broke it down, it sounds like to me, when I'm reading it from the outside, you sign that deal. They say, hey, $2 million. Okay. Just as an example.
Yep.
But of that $2 million, they own all your rights and everything you do, every marketing, every when you go on tour, the stadium that or you know the venue that you're playing in, that comes out of that $2 million. And by the end of the day, you're left with $2,000 to your name.
Pittance.
Is that accurate?
Yes.
Why do they call it a 360
because
though?
There's 360 degrees in a circle, and when I taught songwriting and I did some music business work as well, and so I always tell people that a song is a pie, and if in the spirit of that, your music career is a pie, and of that pie, you can chop it down the middle, and you can go, this is the writing aspect of it, this is the performance aspect of it, then you could chop it again and add, so you add all these different forms of revenue in. And a record label's job, traditionally, is to put out and promote your music. And so that's where their money is supposed to come from. They should have no part of your live performance money or any part of your songwriting money, because publishing and songwriting is a completely different thing. A master of a song, that's what the label owns, because they paid for the studio to record it, right? They paid the producer, they paid them, like that's the traditional idea. But as that so the NSYNC's album came out in 2002, and that was number one album on the biggest week in the history of record sales. That was 2000, I think it was 2001, 2002, I don't remember the exact
name. Don't tell me they signed a 360.
Probably. I don't know what their deal was, but it doesn't matter because that was the day that the music business started shrinking. They stopped. Okay. Like, the music business grew for five decades. Okay? So then it starts shrinking. So all these guys that are used to making all this money have to find new ways to continue to make all this money. So the 360 deal allows them to get money no matter what, because if an artist is paying you just for record sales, they're not going to be paying you as much as they used to. But if they are paying you for publishing and live performance and advertising and endorsements, if the label gets a cut of that, then they're getting money for doing nothing at that point.
So is there different types of 360 deals? So some can be okay, or it's just a bad fucking thing and run?
I think, in my opinion, it's anything that is all-encompassing is probably not a great idea. Now, there's exceptions to every rule. And if you have a one-stop, if you have someone that can help you profit in all these things and asks for a fair cut of all of them, if someone is actively contributing to record sales, booking tour dates, getting you endorsements, creating and exploiting merch, managing your whole situation, then maybe they you should give them 20% of everything. Or it's
right. If they're not shelving it and not helping you out, maybe it's in your best interest, depending on your own capital and so
forth. There's never like but the idea that a record label, who all the record label is doing is paying for studio time and promoting, quote unquote, hopefully, your music, and they're getting money that isn't like they're getting your cut of publishing and
everything.
That's not a good thing.
And that's what's killing a lot of these artists.
It's definitely killing a lot of artists. But I mean, most any artist at this point, for the most part, understands that first of all, terrestrial radio is shrinking. And so there's not as much money. That used to be the biggest thing that major labels were able to do, is they would get you on the radio. And getting you on the radio was how you got on the road and do radio promotion. But with the, the only format that's still really even
possible to put you on a tour, right?
Country radio is still kind of alive because of the demographic, you know. So terrestrial country radio still works, but it's worse. It's not great either, you know. So it's just not the same. So again, that's another thing the label can't do anymore. So if a label can't help you actively make money, which the only way to actively make money big time is by being on the road, selling merch, and getting endorsements and sponsorships and things of that nature, that's why you see, you know, one of the bad things about country music now, unfortunately, is that almost every song has a beer or a truck or a specific alcohol in it. That's marketing. That's marketing. Yeah. And that's
this soulful
that's
song is brought to you by Bricks. Bricks, you can build with them.
Yeah. That's a piece of it. You know, it's like that's a piece of what's going on. And so.
Yeah.
The short answer is 360 deals not a good idea. If you're an aspiring artist, you probably don't want that. But you need to have a lawyer who understands it, read it to you, and you need to understand everything about it. This is the thing that I would always tell him. It's like, we're always going to read everything.
You're always going to read.
Mm-hmm. No, I'm not always going to read. The lawyer's going to read.
Well, whoever's going to read.
A little off genre, you know, but still a good point. I never understood why Baby with Cash Money Records held Lil Wayne's record and all that money. He was the biggest guy at the time, whether you liked him or not. He was the biggest guy at the time. He was selling records through the roof.
Yep.
I don't understand why he would hold his money.
I think it was personal. I don't think we'll ever know.
A personal issue between I agree with you.
I think
something happened that we don't know.
A lover's quarrel.
And at some point we'll find out, but it had to be because it wasn't that this wasn't Chinese Democracy. This wasn't Guns N' Roses. This wasn't this record sucking, like, or not being up to par. This was a guy actively sabotaging.
On fire at the time, actively to the point where what's his name, who got locked up for the fake AIDS, or he was up in the price of AIDS medication.
Yeah.
He somehow stole the album. Wow. And the idiot put it all over social media that he had it. It's you're already indicted, bro.
Yeah.
And now you're going to put an album that you're not allowed to have online and brag to the world that you have it. I'm sure that judge is going to take that into consideration.
That's not going to help. but way to go, bro.
That's crazy.
Yeah. I mean, I honestly had no idea that Lil Wayne had a record shelved.
It was like, it was the Carter Five. You know, it was guaranteed to make $80 million. Oh. Or $100 million, right, Nick?
It was a cash. I mean, there was no bigger star in the world at that point. There were big, but
yep. Yeah. And they held that. So, like you said, it had to be personal to shelve that for almost 3 years to the point where, you know, 3 years go by, it's not the same Wayne as it was back then
It was a career killer.
You're right.
For me, I like to be able to at least in some way control part of my destiny, you know, and that's the interesting thing about, like, I'm working for my brother right now. And so that I've chosen to put that part of my destiny in his hands to a certain extent, you know?
Yeah.
And I'm a married man. And so my wife certainly has part of her destiny my destiny in her hands as well.
Sure. By proxy, does that mean that my hands are on your wife's destiny as
well? No. No, it doesn't. And I know where you sleep.
I don't really sleep.
That's true, actually.
I'll be waiting for you.
Now, being that you're from California, or you guys are from,
yeah.
Did you see that they like made you turn your air conditioner down? They're all worried about everything. And then Colorado, if you had anything smart in your house, you could not turn up your air conditioning.
Mm-hmm.
78, they locked it right here. an energy company in Colorado shut down access to 22,000 customers' smart thermostats on Tuesday, citing energy emergency as temperatures, you know, went high.
Yeah.
That just shows you how bad shit's getting and about to get. Do you have... Remember, it used to always be love, hate.
Yeah.
Now it's fear.
Yeah.
Fear is everything now.
Yeah.
Well, love, it's love and fear. See, that's the thing. It's like the opposite of fear of love is fear. Fear right. and love are opposites. Love, like I said, it's like love and hate are a thing, but fear.
Yeah, I guess indifference and or fear can both.
Yep.
Machiavelli knew something back in 1776. Would you rather be loved or feared? Well, I love to be loved, but if I had to pick, I would much rather be feared than loved, because if loved worked, the world wouldn't be the way it was.
It's true, and it's dark, and what, unfortunately, fear is beautifully, it doesn't have party lines or opinions. Fear lives on everybody who's reactionary. Yeah. So let's say I had a big platform, and one thing I would not do immediately, even if I was sweating in my house, is get online and be like, this is bullshit. Everybody, you know what we should do? We should fucking do it. Here's a hack. We're going to turn on our stuff. Fuck that. Because what if by doing this for a week, which I don't know, but I would say, all right, let's everybody buck up and try this for a few days, and let's get answers. Let's ask, all right, how long is this going to last? What will this do? How much are we going to help with this? And is there any options? Create a dialogue. And if you used your voice to do that, mm-hmm. we're not letting fear win. And now I could in my head be like, this is fucking bullshit. This is reactionary horse shit. But that's not what I'm going to say, because right. then somebody who's crazier than me, who likes my shit and listens to me, is going to take that next level. And somebody's going to get a shotgun or a fucking AK and go shoot up their congressman's house because they're sweaty. This is why that, and this is, you know, an exaggerated version. But like, if something sucks, we should be creating a dialogue and asking questions but
working together.
It's working
like,
together.
That's the thing. Idea. Is like we need to be more of us need to be able to win. The biggest problem I have is that I think way too few people control way too much in general. I think way too few people have way too much money, and I think that, you know, I always get you're acting like a socialist. No, I'm acting like someone who thinks that if all of us had a little more and all of us had a little easier time, everyone would be happy. Like the weakest, when the weak can become a little stronger, the strong will they'll be better too.
Yeah, but then if you tax the rich to pay for that guy who's not even going to work, and that's mm-hmm. how it would go, right. then so what? I'm working 15 hours a day to pay someone to go sit on their couch and have a beer.
Yep, that's, but you know,
discernment on yeah. that's so what it has to be like. So now that's a great point.
Absolutely.
So if let's say I was on the side, which I'm not of anything, I have no side here.
He really doesn't.
But let's say I'm on the side of wanting to tax the rich a little more. I'd be like, all right, well, if that's the problem, if you don't want to pay for a deadbeat, cool. What if we can guarantee with like an actual like contract signs, like we enforce that they're in work, like even starting out like with volunteer stuff, like things that we need, like let's say cleaning up the side of the road, fixing that fucking potholes, whatever. What if our tax is guaranteed a result? Now, what if? And that's the position I would present to you.
If right. Was, yeah. What if what? Right. Say I had $1 billion. Mm-hmm. I would have no problem if, say, they tax me an extra 5%.
Yeah.
And then at the end of the quarter or whenever they're making me pay, within that little bill that I have to pay, they let me know where that 5% went
accountability.
To. That accountability.
Like, that actually doesn't sound like a bad idea.
Did it go to the highways?
Yeah.
Did it
yeah.
go to schools?
Yep.
More teachers?
Yep.
Maybe cops getting trained? Mm-hmm. You know, things like that? Or did you just suck it up and put it to your political yeah. advantage?
Well, see, yeah. that's the problem, is that there's too much money. Like, just like everything else, the fact that there's so much money involved in politics, we were talking about it earlier before the show, it's like, advertising in news, when you're delivering the news, is one of the reasons that there's so much problem with the mainstream media, is because advertising dollars drive news content. That's not how it's supposed to be.
It's supposed to be informative.
Know? And money shouldn't drive politics. Politics and running a government is supposed to be about what's best for everyone.
Yeah, Nick, you were saying that the government came in and with the Pele thing, I couldn't say it
so,
right. It was
so
really good.
Pele, who is
not
basically...
Not Pele, that's the soccer
no,
guy.
No, not the soccer. Pele, yes. Pele. We did it again. So Pele plays soccer. Mr. Pele went down to Washington, D.C., cut a deal with the government to be able to use the airwaves for television. and they get, the government gave it to him for free in exchange for using using at least an hour a day for informational programming, which was the news. But they didn't limit the they allowed him to advertise during the news. And if they had, not allowed advertisement or to drive to be involved in the news, telling the news, then it would have been a perfect situation.
Was his first name James Paley?
I believe so. Yes, sir.
That's the where I went to school. Our library It was the James Paley Library.
Really?
Temple University.
Yeah, he's the he's basically the father of television, as far as that goes.
Yeah,
like Farnsworth invented it, but Paley was the first was the first media guy.
And not that he did it purposely, but by him doing that, it created a fucking mess.
Yeah.
Because now, all the stations, whatever they can make the money on with the advertisement, is what they're going to run, no matter what it is. Because I mean, look, you don't hear about a lot of shit that we should be hearing about.
Sure.
Yeah.
And even things that aren't like super controversial for who's in right now, you're still not even hearing about that.
Yeah.
You know, so it's like they pick and choose what the advertisers basically want, it seems. Which has really fucked the news.
Yeah. When a news program is at the mercy of the commercial that they're running, and if they if company A has done something screwy, and they're your sponsor, you know.
There's your guy.
So that's where I went to college. I remember the Paley Library. Yep. I never knew who it was.
So Paley Fest is like the biggest, like that's where they premiere all the news shows every year. Like so he was basically the father of broadcasting. So Farnsworth invented the television. Paley brought it to everyone.
Makes sense.
And so when
we had
little did he know. Little did he know.
Yeah.
So that's I mean, it's like, but yeah, you got to get the money out of it, and there shouldn't be career politicians. Politicians were supposed to be of the people, and so you're supposed to have a job, and then you're supposed to serve in the government, and it was supposed to be civic duty. That's what it's supposed to be about, because then at that point, that instead of trying to make money, it's not a thing anymore. But
we've gone too far.
To get back to
kind of went the other way.
Yep.
Yeah.
No, they like, and once you have like one thing I used to do when I ran restaurants, is I'd never give a bartender 5 night shifts. That was a rule I had. Because once you give a bartender 5 night shifts, the only thing you can ever do is take something away if it gets slower or whatever. And all of a sudden, they're going to be making less through no fault of their own. So I always said to him, I was like, listen, you can work 4 nights and you can pick up a 5th shift if you want, or you can work 4 nights in a day. But you will never, ever have 5 night shifts because at that point, the only thing I can do is take away from you. There's nothing for you to work for. And business dictates that sometimes, you know, things
that sounds
change.
Like foresight, Nick, something that I don't see in a lot of things.
Right. Well, that was I just learned it by watching people. Like they start because, like, you're taking my shifts away. They're not your shifts. This is a schedule at a restaurant that you are employed by.
Yeah.
And you are working a shift. It's not yours. It doesn't belong.
See, he's better than me, because I'd be like, they're not your shifts, they're my fucking shifts. Just like everything you do under this roof is mine. Your time is mine. Your body is mine.
I own you.
Yeah, I own your ass.
But how are you supposed to tell someone who's made $500,000 a year or $1 million a year that they don't get to do that anymore?
Close to the mic.
That might be a little bit of a problem.
Yeah.
So tell me about the Madonna book.
Mm. Oh, yeah.
There's got to be something behind this.
So my friend Heather Terman and Leanne Tooker are both amazingly talented comedians. Look them up, Heather Terman, Leanne Tooker, and they decided that as super fans of Madonna that they wanted to do a book.
Madonna fans do it better. Yeah, it's an analogy about the queen of pop.
Yeah. So they asked a bunch of people to contribute essays, and I thoroughly respect and enjoy Madonna, because I think that anyone who's that popular for that long and has that, I mean, is that, she's an icon. You know, mm-hmm. She's more than a musician. She's more than a dancer. She's an icon. I think that's someone that you need to understand and appreciate. And so I got to write an essay. And so that's one of my pieces is featured in this cool book. So order that book on Amazon. We would appreciate it. They got merch and everything.
We'll have it in the description and everything for it.
Best Madonna song.
So best
her favorite
my favorite Madonna song has to be Take a Bow. Babyface produced.
He was a beast.
It's just a beautiful song. Best Madonna song, I think it's hard to top like Into the Groove or like one of those heavy dance tunes
A Virgin is absolutely like, I mean, that song is
stands the test of time too.
Yeah.
How about yours?
What was the first one you said?
Take a Bow.
Take a Bow. Take a Bow. That's probably my favorite.
Rob, I'd have to go.
No, I really like Take a Bow.
Tell me the name. Tell me the name. I just know this song goes, life is a mystery.
Like a Prayer.
Oh, yeah. Everyone
like a Prayer.
Those two. Take a Bow.
That one. That's mine.
Yeah.
I mean, the video of that.
Those were the video was beast.
Nick, what's the
when
song?
When we had music videos.
Yeah. Like a Prayer. What's the song on Ray of Light, Nick, that goes, ooh, if I could, blah, blah, blah. I don't remember the song name. But like that's the
Power
song.
Goodbye, maybe.
Yeah, it's the super like electro, like sonic, like massive attack style song.
I mean, mine. Ray of Light's an amazing. Like that album.
Like her hippie like electro. Like she went like super. But that's what Like a Prayer's not on that.
No, Like a Prayer was early. I mean, through the '80s, she basically did that music, you know, and she was like it was dance '80s music. But then through the '90s, she kind of experimented in different places, like the Take a Bow record that she was more soul and R&B based.
Yeah,
Ray of Light was very techno world music element.
I like the chillness of that. Ray of Light. See, what's funny? Like her other stuff is so much more sexually based.
Yeah,
but I could bang way more to the Ray of Light album, just for me personally.
I thought she would be with what's his name forever,
Guy Ritchie.
No.
Oh, Sean Penn?
Sean Penn. He just came back from Ukraine. He looks like he got hit by a Mack truck, and then the Mack truck went in reverse.
Yeah.
They were fierce. I mean, everything says that they were fiercely in love and just so young, and they were just both. I mean, but they were so volatile.
Yeah.
That whole situation.
Well, you know, you had him at his prime.
Yep.
She's still at her prime.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and you can just imagine all that, just shit going on.
Yep.
Do you think that, and I always wonder this, people say this, since you're a big Madonna fan, right?
Yes,
do you think Lady Gaga is the new Madonna?
I think that they are different. I think that Lady Gaga is going to go down as an icon as well. But Lady Gaga she got to grow up and live through the Madonna era, you know? And I think, you know, you look at Bowie before Madonna. Mm-hmm. And that she says it herself that Bowie heavily influenced her. And I think that Gaga got to do Gaga because Madonna did Madonna. But Gaga is, you know, I think there's more. She's kind of different. She strikes me as a different kind of person. I think she sings.
She's a
way
result
better.
Of. I think she's
she
a
sings
result
way
of
better
Madonna.
Than Madonna. You know, like that's one thing. Is like
she got
a
great voice.
Sing.
Got great voice.
Oh, yeah. We went to see her when she did the residency in Vegas. She was going to do it with Tony Bennett, but then she just did it by herself, and it was just perfect.
Incredible.
You know, and
I heard her live on Stern. She's like you.
Incredible.
Just sits down on a mic and it sounds the same as the record with all the gazillion dollars worth of equipment.
Yep. No, she's got a natural talent. And
she can pitch a note, right, Kalen?
she's got great pitch.
Ugly cried at the end of A Star Is Born. It was the second time I watched it in the theater because I went with him and mom and dad.
He
and
contained himself with me, thank God.
The second time, though, the end of that movie, I lost it and just bawled. Like my wife and two of my, John and Michelle, who come up again, John and Michelle Fitzgerald, were sitting there.
I would have just left
for
the
10
theater.
Yeah. It was
A Thousand Years, September 23rd.
September 23rd. A Thousand Years by Christina Perry and now by Kalen Chase. Out September 23rd.
I'm pumping you guys all I can. Kalen, what's your stance? Have you ever done DMT?
Yeah.
Oh, really?
Oh,
tell me your experience on DMT.
So I have.
Have you, Nick?
No, I have not. It's not something I'm opposed to. I just have not done it yet.
So I got some DMT and I was
smoked
shooting
it?
Yeah.
Okay.
I was shooting a music, well, not a music video, but like a video for my band, The Changing, which was metal. So it was all weird comedy. And the end of this video, I have a corncob pipe, which is great smoking apparatus. And so we lit it up and I put a little weed in there and I smoked all the DMT and pretended that I was dancing, you know, to Typo Negative with my silhouette. But the funny thing is I got a little high.
You were on DMT when you did that?
Yeah. Oh. Nothing happened. So
then,
about however many hours later, we were filmed at our party house, which is right off of Hollywood Boulevard, and right next to the bar that Nick was the manager of, and we all worked and hung out, drank. It was 20s, like partying. So we go back to the bar, then come back to the house. There's like 15, 20 people in the house. We're sitting around listening to music, drinking, partying, and suddenly, like everything's quiet. And I realize that I'm wearing a hoodie and everybody's staring at me. And I'm like, what the fuck? They said, what do you mean, what the fuck? You just finished spending about 10, 15 minutes telling everybody's darkest secrets, stuff that you couldn't have possibly known. You made Aaron, our other friend. He just left. Like, somebody else started crying. I was like, weird. And then he was like, no, what's... I was like, oh, guys, I took DMT, and I guess it affected me differently. I just became a prophet. It's no big deal. Opened a beer. It's like, sorry, but I don't remember anything, so back to the party. And that's what happened to me on DMT.
Sorry, I missed that. I'm not.
Everybody I talk to that has done it say that they did it, and they came, when they came out of it, they did it again. And when they came out of it again, it totally changed the way they looked at things. Mm. Like, they became nicer people. Mm-hmm. They stopped being so, it kind of maybe put them in a dimension or a reality that we're not aware of.
Yeah.
You know, and they all came out of it kinder people, nicer people, yeah, looking more at things, not so self-absorbed, more looking at how other people feel,
yes,
and shit like that. Did you get any of that type of shit?
Unfortunately, I've only done it once, and like I've talked to people, no one's ever had a 6 or 7 hour wait, and no one has ever prophesied and not remembered it. So I'm gonna try it again.
Yeah. Well, maybe your adrenaline was so pumped.
Oh, you definitely.
You know,
pretty relaxed. I was just dancing around. Like, I was ready for, I wanted to trip balls and see the little man in the car flying around, but it did not happen. But I've also have a strange, my body reacts to drugs differently.
The worst things that you can give him are sugar and weed. Those are the things that
sugar makes
him
me uppity. Yeah,
what's weed do to you?
I just get, like, now,
zombie?
Joints are fine. For some random reason, I can dome a high-powered California joint while grilling and feel good and giggle. But like, anything else, bong pipe, edibles, yeah, like, I'm just like,
he
it's
goes,
not bad. I'm just like, oh.
He just goes coming. Like, it's just, he's just not good on him.
I'm like a cartoon.
He's great on everything else.
Yeah.
I think those edibles are a little dangerous.
Yeah, you don't know how much.
I know one guy that did a lot, and he never came back.
Really?
No. He never came back.
From edibles?
Yeah.
Was he doing anything else? Was there anything else in the edibles?
Nah, he was just hammering them. He was instead of taking 2 for like 20 yeah, milligrams, I mean, he was taking 8 at a clip.
Oh, see.
People
say like that weed can't, like, you know, you can die from, you can drink too much water. Like, there's, yeah, like, there's too much of
anything in excess is dangerous, but, yeah, potentially.
Yeah. I don't think the plant, I don't think there's anything to worry about with the plant, yeah, or the oil, but I think the edibles, I've read a lot of shit, and I've seen it in person. He came back, and he was never the same. When it was like a 2-day fucking high.
Was he a perma? Was he perma stone now? Like,
yeah. He's just not. He's like not all there. You know when you look at somebody and you're talking to him,
yeah,
and you can tell that they're just not all there anymore.
Yeah, and he might have broken his brain a little.
Yeah, I think it did, because he was very talkative, very outgoing, and he became literally when those 2 days of the edibles wore off, he literally became not outgoing like he used to be, not really motivated, kind of just like a fucking robot that can talk.
Yeah, that's too bad. Wow. So kids, don't eat too many edibles, you dumbasses.
Yeah, I mean, that's the only time I've seen anything with marijuana. I don't think there's anything to worry about with marijuana or mushrooms.
No, I think, I mean, did I tell you about the Viking mushrooms? Like the last podcast, because you've been talking about mushrooms. I had no idea you were, because I've...
Have you done psilocybin?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Tell me about psilocybin.
So,
sorry, Nick.
Oh, no, I'm no, please. Are you kidding?
The first time I did them, I went back up to Washington, where people would fly from Asia to buy mushrooms in Northeast Washington, all over the place. All, like, just grow under cow shit, not on rice cakes, and, like, you know, this is, like, the real shit on the shit. So, these mushrooms are amazing, so I ate a few, and then I decided to make tea and drink the tea, and then I ate the mushrooms that were in the tea. So, I decided to go hard.
Wow, that's a lot.
And so, we're in the country. It's awesome. Like, so many random wonderful things are happening. So I get stuck in time loops on psychedelics. Hail to the Thief, the Radiohead album had just come out, and they were doing the live show on MTV. It was super, like, they were advertising it for weeks. And I was stuck in a time loop, and I knew the next song. I knew the song as it was coming out. Like, before, as they were starting to play it, I was like, oh, I know this song.
But you didn't, though.
I couldn't have, but I did. And that's the beautiful thing about these things. I was walking outside, and the world started doing this. And I was like, oh, no, the world is tipping. I'll probably fall. So I went and grabbed a tree, and I just hung onto the tree, and the world was sideways. And I didn't feel like my arms weakening. It was totally fine. I just had to hold on to the tree. Some friends walked by and said, what are you doing? I was like, what kind of shoes do you have? How are you stuck to the, it was like Hunter S. Thompson. Was like, need some fucking golf shoes. So they got me, and then the world righted, and you know, I just wandered around. It was awesome.
Now, when you came out of it,
yeah,
did you gain anything personally from it?
I think that it got me more into, well, this is recently after being kicked out of the church and moving to California. So it's like, to know that there's ways of, like, you know, the time and space, realizing that
energy
stuff is,
probably,
you know, whether it's an illusion or just beyond our comprehension or multidimensional, it was like, the world is fascinating. I was less bored, which made me a better person. And I ate them several times throughout that week in Washington. Like, my grandparents were upstairs. I made some hot cocoa. And they're like, oh, you're making some hot cocoa? I was like, yeah. And ground up some mushrooms and nom, 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 nom. I brought like 8 grams back for everybody in my band and some friends. So I had just tons of bags of mushrooms. And it was awesome. I had a bad trip, I think the second or third time, and I enjoyed it very much.
When you say bad, what was bad about it?
So stuff like sinking into the floor, thinking you're going to die, like, yeah, it's like I'm going to hell, like darkness, demons, fear. The fun thing is I always visualize a little me sitting in my head on a chair, and he's like, hey, you understand that you're on drugs and that you're not going to die, so this is just a trip. And I was like, oh, well, I like watching horror movies. Let's see what the horror of my mind is like. And I enjoyed the bad trip. I was like, it was fun.
Well, see, I think that kind of trip is supposed to, maybe you're doing some bad shit at the time, and you're supposed to come out of it,
yeah,
and be like, maybe I should do things a little bit differently.
It was,
Kalen's like, yeah, let's do it again.
Yeah, no, it definitely was it was attacking fear. It was showing me fear and showing me that that's...
Isn't that amazing?
So I think there was a positive in there, but like... Instead of giving into it and be like, well, shit, what do I have to do? I was like, nah, I'm fine. Let's just try it. We'll try it again in a couple of days and see how that one goes. It was fine. The Vikings used to eat these mushrooms. And people talk about berserker rage and
right,
the stuff. Now, if you think about it, though, especially like even now, like back then, you know, we're not ancient man at this point. But when you do mushrooms, it's very difficult to be like articulate. Like, you can speak articulately, but if you eat enough mushrooms, there's lethargy. You're slow. It slows your body down.
The first time I saw or had an experience with mushrooms was you and two of your buddies, and we were living in the apartment, and these jagoffs...
We wanted to put a CD on.
They eat a bunch of mushrooms. They go into my room. They stand in front of my stereo, and they're there for 3 hours just standing there, the three of them.
We hadn't put it on the thing. We were watching the wall. It was beautiful.
I was just like, first of all, I wanted to go to sleep. Yeah. I couldn't because they were...
I'm sorry about
them.
That.
Nick's like, oh, shit, here we go.
And he
was just
do
like,
it.
What the hell?
But so that's... thinking about that, how did the Vikings do this? And one theory that's very plausible is one Viking would eat all of the mushrooms, go absolutely insane, and drink a bunch. And what happens if you pee... you still get the mental.
They would drink it.
They would drink the piss. Yep. I think that's the
cool thing. That was in that book. The book that I was telling you about that they banned.
Yeah.
When after they ate the mushrooms, they would drink their own pee because they knew that the liver, you know, they wanted to get all that they could out of it.
Yep. And that stuff is what gives you the sharpness of your brain.
Yes.
So I think if you can, so what they did, so that one guy is just down and out. So he doesn't get to go Blitzkrieg or Berserker Rage. And
it was the mushroom that looks like Santa Claus was the one that they were eating and then pissing and then drinking.
I want that one, please. I'll take those.
So they were drinking their own pee or pissing and somebody drink, like I pissed.
No,
they
would take the mushroom.
Yeah.
And then they figured that they were pissing part of it out. So they would drink their own pee to make sure they got all of the psychedelic effects.
And I thought you were drinking my pee.
And the Vikings.
No, we don't need to be sharing.
The Viking guys only, they all drank that one dude's pee. So they didn't get the body high. They only got the mental high,
right,
which took away the fear, but they didn't have any of the others. So these ancient ones, whoever's doing this, they went the next level where it's like, we're going to get it all, and then we're going to drink all the purities, which probably sent them into a full-blown, like, I'm going to try that. I'm going to use one of my Viking beer horns, eat a lot of mushrooms, drink some mead, and piss in my beer horn, drink that, and see what happens.
I forget what it's called. It's on the tip of my tongue, but what they do is they take two different types of mushrooms, and they mix them together, and it forms DMT.
Yeah.
It's not as good when you smoke it because, you know, you can drink it.
Yeah.
So it goes to the liver and everything. So the hit isn't the same type of bang, but similar. But they make it out of two types of mushrooms. I forget what the fuck it's called.
And am I correct in saying this is the same mushroom, not that mushroom maybe,
But it grows on cow shit, right?
Certain psilocybin mushrooms grow on cow shit. Yeah. There's so many different varieties.
Yeah, yeah.
But
yeah.
The ones up in Washington, they grew on cow shit.
They had those in PA.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Anywhere there's cows, probably, right?
I mean,
yeah, I get
it. Well, they legalized it in Colorado. Except yep. They have study after study of microdosing of yep. mushrooms for depression, anxiety, absolutely. All
I
kinds
bet it's,
of shit.
Yeah, I bet it's.
I need to get into that.
Every single person who's done DMT, like you said, I completely and totally agree based on what I've heard, is everyone comes out of it better. Like, they're actively changed. Like they get something out of it. So like a lot of people, I think, do it a couple of times a year, and it's helping them grow a lot. So
that's why I do speedballs. Because
that is not why you do those. That's a totally different
thing. I don't do speedballs, kids.
And Nick, I did see that. I did. A guy, he was the biggest dick in the world.
Yep.
I mean, just a fucking attitude all the time. You know, if we're all sitting here and we're like, this is red.
Yeah.
Just to argue, just to bitch. He'd be like, well, it's black and red. He went on this fucking DMT thing. He was afraid he was going to die, so he went and did, like, the ceremony shit. You know what I mean? Yeah. The whole thing is paranoid. And he was there a week. I don't know how many times he did it, but I'll tell you what. He came back. Hey, guys. How you doing? The guy never said, hey, guys, in a decade.
Huh.
You know, what do you guys want to drink?
You should do DMT. I mean, I love you, buddy, but sometimes you like to mess with me. You argue for... You like a good debate, so maybe if you did some DMT...
Everyone has their role, Kalen.
Yeah, I'm asking you to change yours and do drugs.
Well, I guess we'll see what happens.
Sick. Right?
Nick, since you're the one who sees all the crazy shit on the outside with a lot of this, mm-hmm. what's your stance on the war on drugs? Do you think they should just all be legal and regulated?
Yeah.
I think, so I have the same stance on basically everything. I believe that once something exists, that trying to take it away and keep it away from people is just making it more, is just a way for people to covet it, a way for it, a black market that doesn't do a lot of people any good, you know, comes up. So I think drugs need to be part of our culture. They exist. They need, you know, I think that locking people up for doing, for smoking marijuana is ridiculous. That I can say. Locking someone up for giving angel dust to kids is not
different ballgame. Yeah,
let adults do angel dust.
Yeah, but any law that says if you smoke this drug you're going to go to jail is a waste. It is perpetuating the prison industrial complex.
Private prisons.
Yep, and that is a problem.
Private prisons. So, keep them filled.
But I feel the same way. So I feel like my stance on guns is this: we cannot no one should take guns away. But making them harder to get is a good idea. That's what I think. Because it's not, like they're not. You can't put it back in the box. Guns are always going to exist. So don't fetishize them.
But Nick, what do they think? They're not. If you take somebody's gun away, who is a big advocate of a gun, what do you think? He's not just going to go down to the corner and get it from the street. Would you rather him get a scratched off serial number gun because he's going to go get one?
Exactly. That's what I'm saying. Don't do that.
Or maybe regulate it a little bit.
That's what we like.
That's what we want. And the same.
I agree.
The same thing with abortion.
Yeah.
Abortion exists.
Now it's getting heavy, guys.
Make
it safe. Make it safe. Like, this is not something that's going to go away. You cannot put Pandora's box is open.
I speak for all women, Nick, in this situation where I say, my body. I did it, guys. Now, am I a hero? Am I getting laid?
My choice.
Oh, is that the rest of it?
Yeah.
I'll figure it out later. I am an ally.
Hey, when's the song coming out, K-Dog?
September 23rd.
Listen to him go.
It's called A Thousand
going,
Years.
Promotional dynamo.
Gotta keep hitting every 20 minutes.
Yeah. That's
I don't know why they went nuts about that damn Roe v. Wade, because it didn't change anything. All it did, they didn't ban states, abortion. States. It's up to the states. What the fuck is?
I'll
what's
tell
the
you,
cry?
The issue is most of it's panic. But yep. I'm married to a Chinese woman, and my marriage is not protected in all states. In some states there could be law. There could be laws that make my marriage illegal.
Really?
Yes.
Yeah.
Because it's not. And so the idea that the federal, like, so I think that federal legislation protecting interracial marriage, protecting gay marriage, protecting a woman's right to choose, is the safe way. And that's what people. But see,
that's just a human right.
Again, and Nick, while we're worried about this dumb, pointless shit.
Yep.
The other countries are getting stronger and
stronger
and stronger. Yep. And stronger. Oh, we're worried about who gets married to who and
exactly.
who does what.
Yeah.
Why are we debating these things? And let's
look at
productive.
The fucking world right now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, China's fucking a year and a half away from invading Taiwan. Biden makes a move. Good night. Game over, buddy.
I mean, China is concerning, but they have been for 40 years. Yeah. I mean, the Russian situation is concerning.
I have a big plan.
But it's not our problem.
Nope.
We should just stay the hell out of it. We're putting all this money into shit that doesn't involve us. Russia's been fighting with the Soviet Union, Ukraine since the beginning of time. The same thing with China and Taiwan. Why are we even involved? That's their battle. Not ours.
We became the Team America World Police. What, that movie's 20 years old.
Money.
You know, and we positioned ourselves in that way. And I'm definitely not an isolation. I want to be helpful, but not at the expense.
Well, you gotta, just because we were good at that. Or, yeah. Like, let's say we did.
It's a different world now.
Yeah, where we need to, like, you know, you can. We did some good. I mean, I know historically America has done some really good things outside of our borders. Now it's time to get in and make sure that I say that I don't give a shit about a lot of stuff, but I care about education. I care about feeding people. If we have people that are getting good education and are eating well, like, feed your kids and educate your kids, watch what's going to happen. We're going to be smarter.
Education's at an all-time low.
Oh, yeah.
They took out wood shop. What else did they took out?
They took out
arts.
Arts. They took out fucking arts. How do you take out arts?
They always cut the arts.
The fact that we don't just have, we should have basic education for everybody and then trade for people who don't want to go into the arts and things like that.
Schools should be cathedrals, man. That's what I'm saying.
I forget what school it is. I don't want to misspeak. I'm not going to mention it. Well, some school in this area, they're doing fundraiser. The kids, literally, I saw it on Facebook. They're asking to raise funds so they can buy music equipment because the district will not supply.
Yep.
For
is that
drums,
not the most?
Band,
that's been going on for 40 years. It's like that's they've been, like they've been cutting the arts since the
80s. That's what keeps kids out of trouble.
Yes.
Because if you're not good at sports,
yep.
What do? You go into the band.
Yep.
Or maybe you are good at sports, but you like the band. You like the instrument.
Yeah.
That keeps kids out of trouble and off that fucking phone.
So that's why, I care right now. It's like, if we could figure out a way to focus as much attention as we could. Here's a great idea. I would tell all the super billionaires, hey, let's do an experiment. For 5 years, we're going to tax you more. And all of it goes into feeding our people, every single child in America and their
nobody
parents, as long as they go to school and including continue,
with conditions,
super conditions. You're being fed, and anybody who needs that help is required to work hard. Like, if somebody has a learning disability, fine, but we just use some discernment. So we feed them, we put arts and education back on the map, doing it right. See what happens in 5 fucking years.
Agree with you, and we get a receipt. We got a receipt from where it went.
Accountability.
Yes.
Accountability. Checks and balances are necessary.
And you don't do it to somebody who makes $120,000.
No.
You know, you do it to, a million and above.
When I was in...
Minimum.
I think $1 million isn't... Like, when I was
in Korn... That is shit right now.
I just moved up the tax bracket. I was on the bottom rung of that tax bracket. I was making a decent wage that put me in the not bottom one. Suddenly, I'm losing a third of my money.
Mm-hmm. You're making more at the other when you were making less.
It was, I was making nothing, so it was still better. But when you're making that X amount of dollars, when 30% of 30 billion is a lot of money, it's like almost $10 billion $10 billion. But you still have 20 fucking billion. I got so frustrated. Right. But you take
30% of $150,000 is $40,000.
Yeah, and suddenly that's a third. This is the difference to me, and this is why my brain gets so fucking annoyed. It's like, we should start the tax bracket. Like, when $1 billion doesn't matter to you, tax them $1 billion.
Right, exactly.
And that's common sense. I believe in, and not just to do it because you're rich, because you worked hard. Let's put that money to good use, the tax man needs to tell you where, and the government needs to say, this is where it's going.
Because then that makes that billionaire, who obviously has companies, it makes it look like an investment.
Right.
Because in my mind, if I have $20 billion, I'm investing in the young, and maybe I'll hire one of them for one of my 19 companies and my other 20 umbrella companies that I'm hiding, that I can hire, really. Yeah. That's how I would look at it. Like, it's an investment, but I want to know what it's going to and who's doing what and when.
Boys, we just solved everything. Yeah. It's like the world
just
should
the
be
world.
Yeah.
There's going to be a 2027 now.
Yeah. Thank God. Because
That's right. 2027. Call back to the last podcast.
You're damn right. It's going to happen. I'm actually finally getting back into stretching.
which is going to help a lot of the stuff for me to like slink around.
Unfortunately, he's right. I've walked in on him stretching.
If I'm going to mediate this orgy and still be involved in it, I got to be able to get out of some sticky situations.
One last thing I got to run by you guys, and then we'll go through everything. So did you see, you know, Epstein, you know, the whole shit with him?
Yeah.
So after he got busted with the girls,
yeah,
he had an office at Harvard. He donated $9 million to one of the, can you pull that up a little bit? Yep. Yeah, he donated $9 million to one of, you know, the things. So after he's hit, he has his, look, he Epstein donated more than $9 million to the university course of read that, Rob.
Harvard University said Friday that convicted sex offender Jeffrey Epstein donated more than $9 million to the university over the course of a decade and had an office on campus after his 2006 arrest. A university review launched in September found that most of Epstein's donations occurred before his 2006 arrest, including a $6.5 million gift in 2003 to help create the university's program in evolutionary dynamics.
And that's after he was arrested. So when you think about it, so when a billionaire, multi-billionaire, you know, donates to, you know, a scientist.
Yeah.
How much say does that billionaire have in what that scientist does?
A lot.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
It's got to play, you can't say that it doesn't play a role. Because if someone invests in me, I'm going, you know, as a human, I am going to keep them up to speed about what I'm doing.
See, I think it goes both ways. Because I think a real scientist, you can't buy.
Right. Well, that's the idea. And I think for the most part, that's the case.
I think a good investor would be like, I know that you're you have a goal. I'm going to leave you the fuck alone while you do this. Like, all I ask is that you do the work that
I'm paying. If you want to let him cook the meal, you got to let him buy the groceries.
But then how can you justify Harvard
allowing
him there after he's busted?
I can't.
With kids.
But I think any, like, what was the old wrestler? I was a big wrestling fan. The Million Dollar Man.
Yeah.
It used to be everybody's got a price.
Yeah.
I think you said no real scientists. See, I disagree with that. I think there's some guy out, you can name a price, and that guy's going to fold eventually. I think it happens.
This is what you do. You would justify it. You'd be like, okay, if I compromise on this thing, I'll be able to do this science, which is how this. Yep. And sometimes it might even work. I mean, this is back in the day, you know, like when I started, there was an opportunity for me, and I'm not going to say names, a pretty big record executive type guy. I was like 18 years old, and basically somebody else said, you know, if you gave this guy a blowjob, you would get a record deal. Now, I am not homophobic. I don't give a shit. It's like I said, we're going to be in a pile in 2027. Who knows what's going to happen? But my reaction then was, fuck, I'll take the pen to sign the contract and stab him in the fucking head with it because I wanted to earn my record deal, not suck my way to get it. Now, repeat that now to me. I'll say, sure, I'll suck his dick because now I will get a record deal that make sure it's a good record deal and I will use that record deal for good to get my music out there. Is that wise or have I just been broken by constant getting close and failing? I don't know, but it's where I am now. I have no qualms, but I like 18-year-old Kalen saying, no, I'll stab a guy who tries to give me something that I didn't earn and put his pee-pee in my mouth. I don't want that.
Right.
But yeah, now I let it be known, rich people. I will suck.
No. Moving on.
I'll save it.
I'll suck you.
I'll say it. I was trying to save it.
Yeah, he was going to get it out.
So for me with the Epstein thing, if you take away the kids, right, I don't believe for 2 seconds that there isn't 50 other Epsteins that women went into that were not going to get that role. And he says, look, let me fuck you, do this, do that.
That's Weinstein you're talking about.
Weinstein is the producer. Epstein was the...
Epstein,
agreed. Same thing.
Same guys. Yeah. I mean, the idea is this. It's similar. Like when people of power...
Epstein,
off,
Weinstein. How could those be so fucking close?
When someone in power offers you something in exchange for... You know,
a star role in a movie, maybe.
Yeah, for sex.
Yeah, for sex or for anytime you're it's not based on merit. Meritocracy is supposed to be the foundation of success in this country. That's what it's supposed to be.
That was the dream.
That's and it is in a lot of cases, but there's always going to be people who circumvent the system. Now, hopefully, after that, the cream still rises to the top. But I think the biggest problem is that we just know now. Like, we know how much of it has happened, and I mean, it's been this way since the beginning of time. You, if you know, if you, if you're beautiful or you're good looking or you, you know, are talented at something that someone else wants, they're going to,
if they have power, they're going to use it.
They're going to use it.
And I'm just playing devil's advocate.
Yeah,
the guy should be have a bullet in his head, but just playing devil's advocate, right?
The minute you start messing with kids, it's
But if you, the kids.
Weinstein didn't do the kids. No, Weinstein did the adults. So we're talking Weinstein now?
No, well, Epstein was the article.
I'm talking the adults.
Okay, got it.
So if you go in there and you're making $750 trying to get an acting career, he picks you. He says, look, I'm going to give you the co-star role, guaranteed $10 million. Okay? Yeah. He's not tying her up and making her do anything. No. He's not pulling a gun to her head.
Yeah.
If she's willing to do it for that role, take away take away all the other bullshit. Yeah. Just that. Is he wrong?
Here's the. This is
when
the slippery.
It's going on in Hollywood, just way more than just him.
Oh yeah, no, it's
and
the
I'm
system,
sure today
the system is wrong.
There
the
you
system,
go.
There, the system is an, the system is the issue, and but it's I don't know how to I don't know
what
how
makes
to fix
it, Well, here's what makes it an issue because a multi-million dollar role, and this is like so. Let's say you're an established actress who really wants a part, and some dickhead producer says, like, but you're living in Malibu, and I want this part. Well, you're not going to get it unless you lick my ball bag. Now, she does that. There's no gun to her head. There's nothing like that, right? That's just the dirty nature of a broken system. Fine. But what if you're a talented person fresh off the bus who's going to be foreclosed or like losing their car, can't afford anything, just got fired, and somebody who can, and people like this, predators can smell weakness, offers you life-changing money. Now you don't have a choice,
right?
And
now
this
you've
is
taken advantage of that person.
You have a choice, but now, it's not a good choice.
Again, I'm playing devil's advocate. I don't agree with it. I'm playing devil's advocate for a good conversation.
Those are different things, right there. Now I want to make sure that the listeners know that I'm not saying that the rich or established lady who's doing it is not being victimized or used. I'm saying that that situation, if she wants the role, she makes the decision. It's still a terrible thing. This person who has no hope right now. That is a, and somebody, and
that's that's predator shit.
That's a predator shit. Yeah. And this other thing is just as bad in a different way, but it's different. And I think we need to start in everything, like we were talking about accountability and discernment.
Yep.
You cannot lump everything. So the dickhead producer who did this to somebody, if we find out and it's like absolutely true, then he should have consequences. The sick predator who did this to people off the bus, there should be a greater consequence, and it shouldn't get lumped in together, and all producers are not evil, and we need to change the system. But the only way you can change something is realizing that there are degrees of everything, and we need to be.
Well, I agree with you 100%. And for the record, for all of us, we were just saying things to have it to discuss it. But we don't agree with any of this shit.
No.
We were just discussing it.
But that's if you hadn't made that point.
It to light.
Anybody who does anything like that, you know, anybody who uses their power.
Yeah.
To elicit people to do things that they may or may not be willing to do.
It's a bullshit thing.
The bottom line is you're taking advantage of a male or woman to give, because you have the power.
Yeah.
You have the power to give them what they want.
Yep.
And
but
you're,
now,
you know.
But now it seems like, too, the thing that I think is kind of wrong, like, right, the best man for the job, like they say, right?
Yep.
Best man for the job. So you see it happens a lot in television now, especially, that let's just use sports, for instance. Let's say there's a job opening for a sports reporter, and they have their candidates lined up. Unfortunately, or maybe fortunately for some people, they don't always pick the best candidate.
Right.
They're forced now into meeting a certain quota, or they don't have enough women, or they don't have
ethnic margins.
Correct. And I understand from an ethic margin. I'm not saying that. Like, yes.
Yeah.
But if the person, either way, white guy, black guy, Hispanic guy, Asian guy, whoever's the best person should get that job. It doesn't go that way anymore.
I agree. Like. But here's the counter to that, because I wish that we could just put the best person for the job no matter what situation. I don't care. The problem is, back in the day, and we have historical absolute proof, we know this to be true, that women
homosexuals, ethnic, they didn't get an opportunity. So what we do as a society is we move things the exact opposite, and it's going to suck for a little while. The only way that we can get it back to a, well, for the first time to a where it matters, is we have to let these growing pains happen and be like, yep, we wronged you for a certain amount of time, and start making it right. And I don't think it's a reparations. It's saying the system is broken. We're going to fix it. So we're basically making up for lost time, but eventually it needs to just get down to, hey, we're going to do a test of this. And no matter what, at this point, we're going to get back to the best person gets the fucking job. But
you're right. It goes either so far this way or so far that way.
Overcorrection has happened. I mean, do you guys know that 1976 was the year that a woman could get credit without the signature of a man? Huh. 1976 is when this happened.
Wow.
The issue that we run into, see, and so this is something
less
that
50 years ago.
This is something that I've been dealing with. So growing up in the 80s and 90s, I felt optimistic that we had basically come to understand that racism was bad, that misogyny was bad, and that, you know, that we needed to fix the environment. Like, I felt like we'd figured all this out and solved all this stuff. And, like, I grew up in a time when Will Smith was just as big a star as anybody.
Fresh Prince of Bel-Air.
Right.
Everybody
knows that. All the, like, Will Smith movies were just as important as, like, Nicolas Cage movies at the time.
Exactly,
like,
right.
You know, the TV, you saw a ton of programming that was African-American focused.
Family Matters.
You saw George Lopez get a show. You saw all this stuff happening. And for me, I grew up and I felt like we'd done it. You know, it's like we saw I knew racism was bad. I understood that.
But great point, everybody else did.
Great
and
point, Nick.
As soon as what I realized is that as soon as the planes hit the towers, a lot of things changed because we got scared as a country. We got really scared, and then I realized, and it as soon as Obama got elected, I felt and saw that racism was alive and well. And misogyny was alive and well, and that's when I found it. Like, it was like that's when it and I like we got work to do. So it's like for me, I grew up feeling like it was a real shocker.
I thought I agree with you, right? When I was growing up too, it's you know everybody was watching Michael Jackson in their house, you know, whether you're white, brown, purple.
Right.
But I think what people have to understand is, and I agree with you on all that. I mean, and nowadays, like, my wife is Hispanic. Mm-hmm. I think everybody's intermixed now. I love when they have, like, the fill out the circle arc, Asian. I'm like, what if my kids fell out? You know? And I think we have solved a lot of things. There's a lot of work to be done with a lot of stuff. But I think, like, you're always going to have bad people.
Yep.
Like, that'll never go away. You're always going to have downright racist people that we know it's wrong. But And sometimes it's not their fault. And I mean that in a way that it's a terrible thing. Like, you mentioned that guy, and it makes sense. If you're brought up knowing or told that if the person's black or white, they're bad people, don't talk to them, and you're taught that from the minute you're born till you're 10, what are you going to think?
And
that's where you can't blame them for being taught that. Maybe they'll learn it later that is wrong.
Well, the only way to do that is, and this is the other side, and we've talked about this a lot, people in the, like, primarily the red or, like, the deep south or whatever you want to call it, people, the arch-conservatives think that liberals are smug and look down on them, and we think that they're stupid, racist idiots. The problem is that's self-perpetuating because if somebody who grew up thinking and was taught that anybody who looked different or anybody who's homosexual or whatever is a sinner or wrong or subhuman, calling them stupid hick rednecks just makes them hate you and the more Absolutely. People just to spite you. Whereas if you sat down and been like, man, I mean, let's look at these, like, look at the facts here. Like, I know this person. I mean, what about that? Like, start pointing out that maybe
have a conversation.
Well, the intelligent thing to do would be, instead of putting green class into high school, maybe put racism class into high school and teach kids that, you know, things are different now.
Yeah.
You know, times have changed. Everybody's the fucking same.
Yeah.
They're just like you. Yep. No matter what they are.
Everybody's different, but everyone's allowed to be who they are. It's like we're all humans. We all come from the same place, and we have different experiences. And my experience, though completely different from yours, is no less viable or important.
Right. Like when when I say different, I mean, like if you're a different color, you're still a human being. We're all just like me.
I think always comedy helps relieve that type of stuff.
Yes.
Like, yeah. You know, where my family came from, my mom's side of the family, I would call them, we'll call them rednecks. I would say trailer park. We used to say trailer park trash, all that type of stuff. But you took it with a grain of salt.
Yeah, you're just joking.
Yeah, my uncle, he is trailer
now
park.
Now it's like,
trash.
Fuck it, you get a case.
Loves, yeah.
You catch a case if you say that.
Yep. I mean, I think the thing, too, is like someone who I know can call me, can make fun of me. Like, I mean, we say awful things about each other. I mean, Lord knows. I mean, we've done horrid things to each other. But I mean, like, if you know that I'm coming from a place of love, pretty much, you know, if you know I'm not out to get you, then it's not going to hurt the same. But we're scared. We as a country, we are scared.
Right. Yeah,
it's a broken system, like both you said, full of fear, and then throw in social media on top of that.
Yep.
Doomsday is what that equals.
But these type of conversations that we're having right now is the conversations that I think everyone should have.
Yeah. Yep.
Whether you believe, like you said, you're red, you're blue, you're this way, you're that way. We could come to some sort of a common ground. I still may not agree with you on this. You may not agree with me on
that.
But we mix and match.
But and then we could say, like, okay, I could see your point there. You're right. Maybe we could do this.
You can always find something that you can agree with somebody on.
Something.
Maybe it's a French fry.
Something.
Maybe your favorite food is French fries.
Something. Yeah.
You know what I mean?
And that's enough connection to at least not make you want to kill
you. We all agree on more than we think.
Me and you both.
Yeah. Well, that's... I've seen it, I've said it, and I believe it's true. Where it's hard to believe it, but getting to travel around, like in 2017 even, getting to travel around America, and from big cities to little rural places, and I remember, I like to people listen because I can't see for shit, but I people listen when I'm in a diner. So I was in somewhere in Mississippi or something, right around there, and we were in this old diner. I was by myself getting some brekkie and two giant truckers hop down and I start talking and I'm like, this should be good. And I fight against this all the time, but I just decided in my brain for a split second that they were probably going to be talking about something ignorant, racist, or like pro-Trump or this or that. No. And this is, I think, my biggest turning point of not being a judgmental prick and stuff like this is they didn't speak English very well. Their syntax wasn't perfect, but they were having this really intelligent conversation about things are getting crazy. Like, I feel like it doesn't matter what side you're on. Like, there's nobody's getting a word in edgewise. And what they were saying is they liked the idea of, instead of having to like run and grab every single thing on their side, on their team, like a fucking sport, that they wanted to crouch over to the, go over to the middle a little bit and be like, all right, these are the things I hold on to. You're on the other side. What do you got? They were saying what we were talking about, two giant old truckers. And I was like, if that's happening, and it's happening there. It's happening in a bunch of other places.
90% of the people feel that way.
I think
it's the 10% that are loud that get us into trouble.
Well, I think it pulls.
It gets people. It gets the 90% to fight each other instead of
it will never happen.
10% shut up.
I think the two-party system is the dumbest fucking thing on the planet.
Well,
in theory, you know, originally in theory it made sense.
Yeah,
but.
I agree.
Now,
it doesn't work.
It doesn't work.
It doesn't serve. The thing is like
disconnect is what it creates.
It doesn't serve anybody. Like
now you have to be a team.
I agree with more of one side than I do the other, but I don't think that only two options is what we need. We need to have more options. I think that like libertarians need a seat at the table, and you know, the progressive side of the liberal caucus needs a seat at the table. And we need to have four or five options.
Yeah, because like Nick, you know, like an independence. I mean, Ross Perot had a shot. I thought maybe I thought maybe because he had a gazillion dollars though.
He had a lot of money.
Ross Perot.
Yeah, he had a lot of money, and he had an interesting idea. He had some interesting ideas.
He did really.
But see, the problem that he had was that he was
off his rocker.
He was
a little bit.
He was a little nuts. I think a guy like I thought Steve Forbes had interesting political, like he was the first time I heard a flat tax, like that was interesting to me. I thought in 2008 if John McCain hadn't nominated Sarah Palin, that could have been an interesting ticket. I mean, like that was the, like, because I liked John McCain and I liked Barack Obama both. I was like, these are two men I want to hear, like I'd love to see the two of them work together.
Can you tell me how he got billions and billions of dollars in cash on a plane in the middle of the night and got away with it?
Nope.
Just curious if you know. Because I think I probably would have got life if I would have even attempted that.
Oh, yeah.
On a good day.
Yeah, that's the problem with politics now. You can get away with all kinds of things.
I think it should be no parties, just, you know, but
a campaign of ideas.
You run and you pick and you vote on whoever you like, whoever you think is best. That
I voted
way everybody
for
has
Arnold Schwarzenegger when he ran for California governor because he said he was going to repeal the gas tax and he was going to balance the budget. Those are the two things he said he was going to do, and he did them. I voted for him the first time, and he fulfilled those promises. And that was one of the only times that I specifically saw a candidate
fulfill what they said
the
they were going to do.
He was shit on the environment at the time. He's been way better since, but
at least he did something that he said he was going to do.
But he ran for those two reasons, and I was like, okay, cool, dude.
Yeah.
Like, I do not hate that vote. Like, I'm proud of that vote.
Sure.
But I think the way our system's set up too, it's kind of good in this way. I don't agree with the two-party system either. Yeah. But someone who's living in rural fuck Mississippi, right? I've never been there.
Mm. It's rural.
And somebody who's living in New York City have different ideas. Like, they care about different things, mm-hmm. you know? So their voice is different than someone from New York.
Yep.
They don't have the smog. They don't have all the pollution. They live in beautiful country, and they support different, have different values than somebody. So I think in that way it works, the two-person, but the way the government's supposed to work is you have a voice at the table even if you live in bumblefuck Mississippi.
Well, the problem with the two parties is who's ever in never gets anything passed because the other party fights it.
Yep.
Even if they have the House and Senate, they get more passed than if they didn't, but they still fight everything. Then the next person that comes in, if they're with the other party, even if it's a good bill, just because it's the other party, they retract it.
There's a
and
bunch
put what
of,
it, and it's just the cycle fucking continues.
It's divisive. Well, people spend way too much time worrying about who's running the Oval Office mm-hmm. and not enough time about who's actually
policy,
running the
policy, yeah. Like policy,
it
be, policy.
It needs to be about what needs to happen. And that's
Nick,
why
policy, right?
Policy.
And what are they doing?
Right.
Not about what they're doing on Twitter.
No.
Policy.
Policy.
What are they doing?
What did you accomplish today? You know, it's like what is the goal? And I mean, a president doesn't have power, and the economic choices a president makes when he's in office don't really take effect until after he's out of office. You don't know either. Like, economics is half prophecy and half, you know, science and some math. You know, it's like it's like people think they understand it, and so they read a couple of tweets, and all of a sudden they're an expert. I'm like, no, I don't know shit about economy.
One quick thing, and then we'll go to the Instagrams. That fucking raid on Trump. What the hell? And then the way that they plant the pictures and they put the empty folders of like classified out, like the way they laid that out and then took a picture and posted it.
Oh, well.
He got the master though. Yeah. He got the master.
Oh, he was always going to get that.
Yeah, because I mean that search warrant was
it's all pageantry. It's all like, I mean, I am no fan of Mr. Trump at all. I don't agree with how he does business, but it's all pageantry. He is the result of the two-party system. That's what we have. Like he is the antithesis of the two-party system. And now, what we're going to see next is going to be interesting because there's going to be another one and another one after that.
I'm thinking about running.
I mean, did anyone see that coming? A reality reality TV star who's, you know, I mean, that dude was losing his hair in the '80s, and I mean,
But I mean, forget the person. Just the fact that you raid a president and then you put out papers to make it look good on social media and to the newspaper.
Oh, that way that was done is...
It's crazy. Yeah. It's just crazy. Forget about who they did it to. Well, just the fact that they did it is crazy.
That's the problem because
it's like they've been doing the same thing to, like, I mean...
Raid presidents?
Well, this stuff, like the first thing...
Three and a half years on Russia and there's nothing? With the dirtiest guy on the planet, Mueller, who put five of my friends away and set them up to the end? And he couldn't find one thing? Believe me, if he could find a fucking stone, he would have found it.
I mean, you had... clearly, he didn't get done. Do you remember in the 90s when they tried to... with Clinton and the...
Monica Lewinsky shit?
Well, no, not that. This was there was a videotape called the Clinton Chronicles that circulated, like, in our small town.
That guy's dead.
surprisingly not.
Oh, he didn't fall off a plane or disappear?
Not yet. I guess, but it was
maybe they're having trouble.
It was this weird tape where, like, they tried, like, none of it true, you know, but like just this like weird home video of all of these things that apparently the Clintons did or didn't do. Some of them probably did, but it was just like, but everyone thought it was the, like, everyone who saw it was like, have you seen this yet? It became this sensationalized thing.
They believed
so
it because
exaggerated.
Yeah, that's the problem.
That's the whole thing. It's like, it's not about, it's all about winning and losing instead of doing what's right.
Yeah. Yeah. On both sides on that situation. On and
they're hatchet jobs to, it's like, okay, this
they're
guy,
all
this
in
guy
it
made,
together
yeah.
too, some of them. Some of them are in
oh, that. It's all a puppet show.
I personally think that half of these guys, like, there's a plan in action. My little conspiracy is, like, half of these people have mistresses that get abortions who are telling the people that because they're God, you know, in the Bible, because they know they keep their constituents yeah. happy because yeah. they've made him think that the most important thing in the world is that we can't have abortions and we keep our guns. And these guys who are doing this, half of them, they don't give a shit about that. No. They're keeping us riled up and I think they're working with the arch liberals who are making me make sure that everybody gets a fair chance.
The ultra rich are all running the show together. And yeah. And we're all
on it together.
Yeah.
They're
yeah.
all in cahoots.
And I want to get in on that. I want part of that.
I know, but we'll work on it.
Sounds so much fun. To
I know. Me. Listen, hey.
Pick
don't have
a couple
time.
Reels, Kalen, that are because that oh, really, yeah. you yeah. got some good shit on here. I couldn't narrow it down to pick for myself.
Tell me which one.
That was pretty funny for the top middle.
Right here?
Yeah, this was just a quick little thing I did.
You got volume on?
Oh, I don't think there's volume on.
Ah, the TV. Here we go. Replay.
Get out anyway, because I got writer's block. The song's called A Thousand Years. To promote it, I'll drink a thousand beers. It's better than pinching a thousand rears. Oh, yeah.
No!
You're right.
No.
Is that you?
Yeah. He's running the camera on that. Oh, yeah.
You pick a couple more.
Let's see here. Shit.
The one up there was pretty good. You go up, Rob. Up. Right there.
This one?
Yeah.
Oh, there's Happy with.
I'm sorry. Got a little love left in a heartbeat. I'm not done falling. In love, there are calamities, sweet tragedies. I thank you. May not be the one, but I am moving on.
Oh, yeah.
Wow, that's a, who, now who is that with you?
That's the Daily Fair.
Who's featured on A Thousand Years, actually.
Yep, and then my drummer Brian Keeling, Nick Paul, is playing piano and singing.
It's such a, like...
Thousand
like,
Years, just September 23rd.
Listening to that one again and just seeing it, like, there's passion in it. Like,
super
man,
passion.
Got,
all of them.
Dude, it's killer, man.
I figured out, I found a character that had passion, and I emulate the person every time.
That's a killer song.
Thank you so much.
Seriously.
Pick another one, guys.
Let's see here. There's a...
What are you doing in that picture? there's... The hello is funny.
Oh, yeah.
It's like a delay.
Hello. It's me. You in shameless self-promotion from behind your smartphone screen. But it's different because proceeds go to charity.
American Foundation for Suicide Prevention.
So
very cool.
Play the fucking ball. If you don't, then you're a huge asshole.
That's awesome.
And I'm sorry, but it's for
that's my job.
Making the world better and stroking my ego.
That's awesome.
You got some vocals, man.
And you really were raising money for suicide?
Yeah, it was a competition to.
It was a fundraiser in competition form.
So if I got up high enough, I would have gotten to play the Hollywood Bowl. On the last day, the top two in my team, my group, go to the next round, like this, the finals. I got third. I spent 12 hours on straight on Instagram.
He was IG living for like 12 hours.
12 hours. And we got super close, and then it didn't work out. And I'm not bitter because we raised a good amount of cash
good
for suicide
you.
Prevention.
That's awesome.
Which is.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Well, that's a fucking
and
good
Nick
charity.
Well.
Nick was there the whole time with
congratulations,
me.
Nick.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
That was a day.
And then we tried to go get ramen, and the place didn't have ramen.
Oh, man.
I was so pissed.
Go over to Nick's.
Yep.
They didn't have any ramen noodles?
They were out of everything. It was late night, and I was fucking furious because it was my craving.
One of those nights. Yeah.
I was sad.
Oh, there's your Madonna.
Yeah, there's your Madonna.
Oh, yeah, that was my Madonna.
Oh, yep. And then there's that show from MI.
Oh, yeah. This is some throwback.
Right here?
This one.
What's that there?
Picture. So that was me playing at my school.
Oh, and yes, actually, there is something we can plug that is coming out. Our old bandmate Joe Nagel that we were in Time
to
Dragon with has a song that her and
is
I.
Is that on here?
That is right there, I believe.
Which one, right here?
I think the third. Yeah, that one. Yep. So this is coming out this Friday.
Oh no, okay. The left of that.
Oh, sorry. Right here. Oh, right here.
Left. Yeah.
Sounds good.
Oh, she's awesome.
She's amazing.
Oh yeah, she's got some vocals on her.
Oh,
you can hear them. This is good.
Thank you. Yeah, this is coming out this Friday.
You gotta text me the link to it.
I absolutely will.
Have it all in the description for you guys.
That's awesome. Yeah, we used to play this song. She wrote.
So it was one of those. So we were rehearsing and I hit the chord progression and then she wrote the lyrics.
Yep.
And it took an hour. It was like an hour long situation, and that was one of those things where it's like we never quite perfected it, and then
she took it upon herself and brought Nick back in. I mean, we're surrounded by very talented, wonderful friends.
Yes.
We have a great community of musicians, and everybody is doing amazing things.
Yeah, I'm
the best and the most important.
Ask you. And, tell us all about it.
Well, yeah.
So when's that? What's going to be the next single so I can bring you both back for?
So I think what we're doing quarter four, as it were, is we're gonna probably try and launch.
Wait, 1 second. I don't know. Should we not tell any secrets? So here's what what are we doing?
Okay, how about when is the next single gonna come out?
We got to do something in the beginning of the year. After we do this, we're gonna
ride the rest of the year. But we're gonna be doing a big project quarter four. His birthday is December 7th.
Yes.
And we're gonna be doing
some stuff.
A lot of like a big deal. I think we're talking about possibly, you know, trying to get that record out in the next 4 months. And so we're going to be doing some
maybe work on that. And that's if we can book some tours and stuff like that. But we're going to do like, I don't want to promise anything because life is different. And if I don't have tours, it's going to be single, single, single. But we're not going to leave people hanging.
How about this? I'll see you in December.
Yeah.
I'll see you guys in December.
Can we come back in December?
There you go.
That way nobody says anything, right?
Yeah.
I have this fear of
not delivering on promises. And I already dealing with, like, even though my drummer Joey is dead and in the ground, God bless him.
Sorry to hear that.
It was a tough.
Sorry to hear that, Nick.
But
he was a good dude.
He's amazing. The band Vimic was his band. And really well-meaning people. So is that Vimic record still going to come
every
out?
Every time he posts.
It's important to them, and I understand it. But it's like, guys, and other people have asked if they, like, to, like, reform Vimic with like, as a drummer. And they're like, I'll play drums. Like, no. So we, like, I hope the record comes out, and if any of,
we don't
and
have
I'm
any,
not pissed
we don't
at
have
anybody,
the ability to do that. Like, there's no, wait, like, he.
My
like,
hands are tied, but more importantly, if the drummer, maybe give it a couple, like it's been a year since he died, give it like another year. But and I appreciate everybody's support and I know how much you love it, but stop it.
There's nothing we can do.
So relax,
so it's like, and I said, like, when things were going great, just relax. Like we were promoting, the record was coming out. I had a buttload of interviews and posts and everybody's promoting the record. But Kalen, you said on your post that the record was, well, a bunch of shit happened, and then for a few years nothing happened, and then I lost a friend. So for this stuff, I'm like very, very careful. I'm like, the record will come out, songs will come out, and in December something fucking awesome is gonna happen. Probably my nudity. I can guarantee.
That's why I didn't ask you about the record like last time, because I figured if there was any headway, you would have mentioned it to me. So why beat a dead horse?
Yeah. Well, also, I stopped Nick not to be rude, but because I was like, oh no, I don't remember exactly what the plan.
I mean, basically the idea is that we're going to be launching the promotional idea.
Yeah, promotional
idea. Right around then. So December is a great time to come back and talk.
So yeah.
You're doing it,
beautiful.
You're launching it. When's your birthday?
December 7th, Pearl Harbor.
I was just going to say a date which will live in infamy. So that's only your promotion right there.
Yeah. A date only will Kalen. Live in infamy.
That would only happen to him.
I thought it.
And Tom Waits.
And Tom Waits.
Tom Waits and I share a birthday. Which is
really?
I share a birthday with George Strait.
Ah.
Nice.
Which is pretty cool.
Wow.
That is cool.
Yeah, but I have a national tragedy. But yeah.
So, well, I guess we'll see you guys in December. We'll pump all this.
God willing.
Send me all the links so I can have them all in the description. And let's get 1,000 years pumping.
923, humans.
Featuring the Daily Fair.
Featuring the Daily Fair and not my nudity.
Not his nudity.
Well, we haven't done the music video yet.
And he's holding his breath until you do, I'm sure.
I'll probably have to direct it. It's gonna suck.
I want lots of like old...
No.
Like light, no, you know, like how no, they did like German expression films. Like I want you to see it.
No,
but we also should bathe.
Can we
in the
stop?
Shower. Yeah.
All right.
Yeah, and you guys played two awesome songs
Thank
today.
You.
Two last time you were here, all four banger, banger, banger.
Yep.
Well, we have to maintain that when we come back, so we don't fuck it up.
Okay, we're gonna have to write some songs.
Okay.
Hey, and
well, you just came here four bangers in a row. So,
and when he hits the big places, we want backstage pass.
Of course, yeah. Guys,
you'll be there.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, when this suddenly popped, you know, like should always for some odd reason.
Yep.
You go, and then just one day out of nowhere, it's like boom.
Yep.
And you're like, what? Okay, here we go.
That's the dream.
That's how it goes, though, right, Kalen?
I've seen it a million times for other people, and I'm waiting for my turn.
We position ourselves for success.
Yes.
We are prepared and ready for when it comes.
I sent that, when he was on the last time, that song, Happy, I sent that song to a bunch of friends. Not one every person's like, holy shit, who is this guy? Holy
that's
shit.
Amazing.
That's
amazing.
Kalen's wife asked me, and she goes, are you doing something? I said, no, I'm not doing anything. She goes, you're not there, there's no trick in this. Spotify? They're fucking impeccable. You can't, they're region based.
Yeah.
Only US and Canada accounts with them.
Yeah. Yep. You guys have done so much
what
for
the
us.
Fuck could I do?
Well, I mean, you know, it's like, I'm not that lucky usually, so it was just like, yeah, come on.
Yeah.
But no, I really appreciate your guys' support, and it's always fun having the interesting conversations that we have.
Yeah,
it's been a pleasure. I'm glad I got to be here.
2027, you guys are invited.
Yeah, thanks for coming.
Oh, I always, you never reply back, but I always remind you, 2027.
I changed to an iPhone now, so I lost all my texts, but I've got
it. But why, it's green sometimes it's... Blue, what do you do? Turn what's he doing?
He's
I don't know.
Bad cell reception. He also had his cellular data turned off the other day.
Oh, so
like,
that's
my phone's not working. And I'm like, give me this.
I think it was like 2 days that it wasn't working.
Oh, yeah, the 2 days before you're about to come in here. And I'm texting him like, hey, is there anything special?
I'll give you my number.
Oh, that's a good idea.
Yeah.
I'm not good with like things break around me that involve cellular and anything technological.
See, with me, I just can't find anything. I spend half my day looking for shit.
You know what? We all have little things, but you know we're all beautiful people.
Indeed.
Yeah, and everybody who doesn't think that can suck my balls.
Hey, why?
Or take some DMT.
Take some
everybody
DMT. Everybody needs to take some DMT. Yeah. And relax.
Go to Colorado and have some DMT.
This podcast is brought to you by Hand Soup. Soup with your hand.
Anything, Rob?
Wow, yeah, that was great.
Anything else, guys?
That was great.
Just happy to be here. 923,000 years. Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
An honor to sit across from two guys that have this much talent. Whew. Thank you, guys. You guys are great. And personalities. And you both have brains.
Yep. Somewhat.
Somewhat.
Yeah.
Haven't killed them yet.
Well, we had quite intelligent conversations.
It was. I enjoyed speaking bands. With you.
We
know,
feel the same way
very
about
fun.
You guys.
Yeah. Very fun. Thank you guys very much. Always a pleasure. And I will see you in December.
Absolutely.
Both of you.
Yes.
I'll be there.
Cheers.